I guess it's just you and me, Froggy, because I don't see any Fester. I don't see any Roxanne.
Morning, sweetie.
I just don't think these folks take this job seriously.
Fester's here. I saw him. He's getting his headphones. Call me Mr. Responsibility.
No, I'm not going to call you Mr. Responsibility because I expected you to be somewhere yesterday, and you just dodged out. You just ducked out. No call to me.
Oh,
no
yeah, how'd
text.
That go? How'd that go yesterday?
Yeah, I think you know. You probably saw the video.
Okay, so I missed nothing.
Yeah.
I knew that was going to happen.
Yeah, yeah, sure you did.
I called ahead and asked.
All right, so everyone's wandering in now. Guys, is it too much for me to ask for you guys to be here?
I mean, guys, come on. Yeah,
obviously it is.
Just
okay?
too much.
Guys.
Stop asking. So here's the deal. I'm opening up the show. It's just me and Froggy. I've got Fester and Roxanne just wandered in. And Froggy is touting, what'd you say?
I said that I'm responsible.
Yeah,
okay,
and then I said, well, you kind of bailed on us yesterday. Now,
first of all, you always say, let's go to lunch after the show. We never do.
I never say that. That is not true.
A couple weeks ago, you said, let's go get chicken tenders, and it never happened.
That was sarcasm. He was never going to go.
I thought yesterday was sarcasm.
No, it was, it was not.
Oh, I see what happened. So you knew I wasn't here and you were just going to have a guy's lunch?
No. Roxanne, you don't know what's going on. Hold on.
You don't know.
You left early yesterday. So let me explain exactly what's happening here. Yeah, a couple of weeks ago, there was something that came up. I said, yeah, let's go get some chicken tenders.
Yeah, and I was there waiting for you guys.
You were not at PDQ down.
For an hour.
You were not at PDQ.
I was like, is anybody else going to come to the morning show lunch?
You were not down on 4th Street waiting for us. Cut the crap. All right, so here's the deal. For all of you early listeners, if you didn't hear this develop, there was a story that rolled out that, hey, guess what? An item that we talked about like a month ago, maybe even over a month ago, we talked about how Krispy Kreme, how they were launching Krispy Kreme glazed donut flavored ice cream. And we had a story back in July, and I was talking about how it was going to launch in North Carolina because Krispy Kreme is based out of like Greensboro or wherever the heck they are. Somewhere in North Carolina. So we had the item that, hey, Krispy Kreme is going to roll out this ice cream that's flavored like glazed donuts, and this is their foray into ice cream. And it was like going to be North Carolina, South Carolina, and then the Florida markets, we were going to get it later on. And then I suddenly saw a story earlier this week that Krispy Kreme now has the ice cream at all of the Tampa Bay area locations. And I'm like, dude, let's go. We'll all meet right after the show at 10 o'clock. This is yesterday. And we'll do an Instagram Live on my Instagram account. We'll do an IG Live video. And we'll review the new Krispy Kreme glazed donut ice cream live on my Instagram.
What a concept on paper.
So, Roxanne, you were gone because you had something to do. And Fester, you were here. Froggy, you were here. I said, okay, let's go right after the show. And I get there, and Fester's waiting for me. And there's no Froggy. I'm like, where the hell's Froggy? And then Fester says, oh, yeah, he said he'll be here. He'll be here any minute. And we're waiting for you. And then suddenly, Fester gets a text, like some kind of BS. Oh, I had to go home. My kid has pink eye. What? Is that the best you could come up with?
Well, he had it last week. It was the best lie I could come up with.
Dude, come on. What is wrong with you? I mean, you already do the minimum for the show as
what?
it is.
Excuse me? Fine. Well, then, Impression Connection, I'll let... Right. I'll let you host it, and Hal will take the morning off.
Listen, okay, I get a bit out of you every 2.5 to 3 weeks. All right, so...
What a prick.
Listen, you were supposed to be with us at Krispy Kreme yesterday.
What did I miss?
Well, obviously nothing, because the ice cream machine was not working.
So we
get to Krispy Kreme, and the machine was down for cleaning. And then the guy makes a joke. I promise this is not McDonald's.
He did say that.
Because
the machine wasn't broken.
Well, because there's a McDonald's issue, and this has become sort of a thing that the McFlurry machines are like always down. And even some guy even started a website to track whether the McFlurry machine was working. Is it the I guess it's the ice cream machine, right?
Yeah.
It's not the shake machine.
No, the ice cream machine.
It's the ice cream machine at McDonald's.
Soft serve machine.
It's like the Taylor ice cream machine, which they use for the McFlurries. But that's become a thing like nationwide that the McDonald's machines are like always down. And that's become sort of a meme.
There's like a full investigative like documentary about that on YouTube.
Exactly. Yeah. I've heard about that. We've also, remember we talked about this crazy story about the maintenance of those machines and a company that tried to do like a third party deal. And it's like ice cream mafia. It's crazy. It's like the fight between the New York Ice Cream Company and Mr. Frosty up in New York City.
Yeah.
So, all right. Yes.
Roxanne found the website McBroken.
That's right.
And that's the site that has all of the working and non-working.
Right. So it's called it's called McBroken. And we talked about this.
Oh, that's right. It tells you which store it's broken.
Hold on. Roxanne, are you mute all of a sudden?
Yeah, she's like,
what are you, mute? You're like pointing. It's like you're doing pantomime over here.
Yeah, what's happening?
You can speak.
Okay, yeah. I'll be at McDonald's tomorrow, 11 to 1.
Great. Okay. Wait, you didn't want to say McBroken exists because you have a McDonald's remote? Big deal. That's awesome. Listen, love McDonald's.
McDonald's is an American institution, but there's a problem with the ice cream machines, and it's recognized. It's noted. That's right. The website McBroken. We talked about that, I think, last year.
We did.
I think we did that a year ago. All right, so anyway, we go to the Krispy Kreme right down on 4th Street. We get there at about 10:15. I'm all excited to try the glazed donut-flavored Krispy Kreme ice cream, and the machine is in the cleaning cycle, which apparently they've got to do it every 2 weeks or something. Like, it's a special deep cleaning every 2 weeks, and we get there, and it's deep cleaning.
It's like a 30-minute cleaning.
Once every
2 weeks.
No, the guy said 2 hours. He said 2 hours. Can you hang out for 2 hours? That's what the guy said.
Oh, two hours. Okay, right. Yeah, watch a movie and then we'll have it.
Right, so we shot a video. So if you want to see the video of my utter disappointment, and then we asked the guy, confess to get on the conveyor belt and get glazed. He didn't like that. And,
right, but, I would not have fit.
And then Fester peels out of the parking lot. Fester, I'll get into more of these details later on, but your car jammed in the shrubs of the Krispy Kreme parking lot. Your front end was over the curb. You back up, and it's like,
what's the matter with you?
And then he peels out of the parking lot. All right, if you want to see the video, it's on my Instagram, on my personal Instagram, Certified MJ Radio, Certified MJ Radio. And Andrew, if you could take it, let's put it quickly up on MJMorningShow.com with a little blurb. And the video quality, the streaming quality, it's not very good because I don't know what the problem is, but Verizon Wireless sucks in like the northern 4th Street area.
Wait, I have a Verizon gig tomorrow. Can you know?
No, but listen, I've been a Verizon customer for 20 years, and Verizon service is typically very good all over the place. But in our office park here at like 4th Street and Gandy area, and then down, the data is just terrible. It's all, so my video, instead of being crystal clear, it's all like grainy and pixelated because the data, so, oh my God, look at the time, I'm running late. All right, hang on, quick break. Back in a second on the MJ Morning Show here on Q105. We're just getting rolling. The Holland. Now, we postponed it, and I'm sorry for any disappointment. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Why did it just shut off? It's like the applause just shut off there. You hear that?
It's like the building just exploded.
Yeah.
Or they all got carbon monoxide.
The whole nightclub where the hell she was performing that song, it just like entered a black hole. Yeah. It just went boom. It just disappeared. The crowd applauded.
All right. That was.
Yeah.
Death.
That was it. It was over. All right. So. I know that some of you were disappointed yesterday. We touted and teased the Impression Connection, which, a lot of people have turned this thing into a hit. I was a little skeptical, I'm just being honest, that I thought it was going to be kind of a dud, and I was still on the fence about Impression Connection. Of course, it's a Froggy Hal Herman production, yes. You know, one of the little, you know, phone-in little contest game show deals, and I was kind of on the fence about it. I was like, yeah, not really enthused, but then the listener response was huge, and then my daughter Chloe, her response was huge, and she's like, oh my, I love this Impression Connection, and we were supposed to do it yesterday, but then Roxanne had to leave early, and Roxanne is an important part of Impression Connection as far as one of the players of the game, and the interaction with you, our listener, the one listener.
Sometimes.
Yeah, hey, I'll tell you what. We did postpone it. We were going to do it yesterday, and we did not, so we will do it this morning. Impression Connection, sometime a little after 7:45 to 8 o'clock, somewhere in that window. We got a lot to do at 7:45 to 8 o'clock, but it'll be somewhere in that area. We will do Impression Connection, where if you don't know the game, quickly, Froggy's got a bucket of celebrity names written down on a piece of paper. We get a whole line of contestants set up here. You call in, and you have us pick the name out of the bucket after you choose whether it's going to be me, Froggy, Fester, or Roxanne. We pick the name out. Then we see what celebrity name is on the little sheet of paper. Ooh. Then we have to do an impression of that celebrity. And then you, the listener, you've got to guess who we're trying to impersonate. And that's Impression Connection.
We've got a lot of celebs in the bucket this week.
Where
a lot
is
of
the
new
bucket?
Ones.
I don't see the bucket.
Don't worry where the bucket is. The you're going to want to cheat? Well, I know.
Listen, it's just that, you know, you're somewhat irresponsible from time to time. And I can see, you know, 7:55. I'm like, okay, let's play Impression Connection. You don't have the bucket, or you can't find the bucket. Or
do other morning show hosts belittle their co-host this much? It's just
at
constant.
Length, at length.
What?
I mean, we're children.
I mean, what? God.
Listen.
What are you guys talking?
You realize I'm 42 and not 26 anymore.
As Fester and I were waiting for you to show up at Krispy Kreme yesterday, you never showed up.
I have a business to run.
Oh, I thought it was pink eye.
Yeah, that too.
So what is it? You have a business to run, or your kid has pink eye?
I have responsibilities, sir.
I mean, you spend a disproportionate amount of time trying to take jabs at Froggy, maybe some at me, occasionally at Roxanne, and just,
are you filing a complaint?
No, we're just waiting for it to end. Eventually, we'll get to something funny. People, stay with us. All right, coming up next.
Okay, you do it. Go ahead.
Go ahead. Listen, coming up next.
You guys run the show.
You guys have no idea how crazy yesterday was.
At the Krispy Kreme place?
No, forget the Krispy Kreme place.
MJ, help me, please.
No, I'm out.
No!
please come back.
It's 6:25. I'm out.
Okay. You know, good.
Step out.
All right. Ted, great news.
Fester, I'm out.
One more music. See you, Frog. All right. So, yesterday, I get a Facebook message from a crazy, crazy fan of somebody we talked about earlier in the week. On Monday, we did the New York Times story or New York Post story about the woman who thought she was too sexy for her job and how she was fired from two jobs because of her body. And she had a little TikTok page, and we took calls on it, and it kind of blew up. The woman's name was Nina. Nina, what band was she in, Froggy?
MJ, do you know?
Yep, I'm out.
what band was she? You knew she was. What band was she in?
Yeah, she was in a band called, like, Dragon... Fight of the Dragon, okay, or so Flight of the Dragon.
A rabid fan of this band, Flight of the Dragon, or Fight of the
guys,
Dragon.
Guys, by the way.
Are you back?
I'm out.
Okay, good. So a rabid fan sends me a Facebook message to the MJ Morning Show Facebook page.
Okay.
And all he says is, why you dissing on my girl Nina?
Mm-hmm.
So I write back, Nina who? And he says the name of the person that we talked about on Monday and said a link
to this.
It's
Nina Osegueda.
Right. And then he says, I know her personally, and you guys totally got the story wrong. How dare you? Need to issue a correction.
All right, I'm back in.
Okay.
All right, so I had a New York Post story. Right. It was last week.
You really did fest. Nice.
The headline was something to the effect that I'm too sexy for my job. I've been fired from two places. So we tell the story, and as I'm reading the name of the woman, then Froggy blurts out, she's the lead singer of this heavy metal band. I'm like, what?
She has a great. You should play a song at some point. She has a great voice.
You don't know what a big day today is for her.
Wait a minute.
What?
But nowhere in the story that I had did it mention that she was the lead singer of a heavy metal band.
Froggy sniffed that out.
That's what I'm saying, that Froggy blurted out during... Froggy's like, wait a minute, that Nina what is it?
Osegueda?
Whatever it was.
Osegueda.
And I'm like, what? It doesn't say it in the story that she's the lead singer of some, like... underground heavy metal band, and then Froggy turns out he was right that she is the lead singer of this underground heavy metal band that actually has quite a national following.
Yeah, they're not really underground. So kind of big.
Is it the Duchess? Well, no, that's right.
Then this crazed fan apparently gets a hold of Fester on our Facebook page and rips us.
Wow.
Was it Facebook or email?
It was Facebook Messenger, so we got the message directly.
So he knows her.
So he says, I know her personally, and you got the story totally wrong.
And the guy's, like, excoriating us. The guy's, like, ripping us apart. Well, guess what? Fester, you contact her? What happened?
I don't know who this guy is. I don't know who Nina is.
So how did you end up talking to Nina for 45 minutes? Yeah.
Right?
Fester's
you
on the phone.
You talked to Nina
Osegueda? We're best friends now.
Fester's on the phone with Nina Osegueda. Now, what's her band's name? Do we know the name
of
the...
Sounds of Thunder.
Sounds of Thunder, yes.
Okay, the band is called Sounds of Thunder. Fester's on the phone with this Nina Osegueda for 45 minutes yesterday, as I find out.
He's a talker. Cool?
So I write the guy back, and I don't know how much I want to engage with this guy because he's really kind of pissed off at us. You know, I just assume
we're running late here. Just get to the point.
I said, hey, listen, he's back. If you know her so well, here's my cell phone number. You have her, give me a text. Tell her to reach out to me. He's like, no, you reach out to her. I'm giving you an opportunity to make right. I was like, listen, here's my number. Have her contact me. And you know what? 20 minutes later, I get a text. Hi, Fester. This is Nina.
What?
Yes. So I called her back and she was lovely. We talked the whole thing out. She's going to come on today with
Fester,
us.
What?
Fester, that's amazing.
He calls me and Fester is gushing after a 45-minute phone call. So she's going to set the record straight because the story from the New York Post last week.
Completely wrong.
The story was, I'm too sexy. My body is too much of a distraction. I've been fired from two jobs. And so we're going to put the whole story together. And she claims that maybe there is some misrepresentation in the story.
Yes, by misrepresentation, the entire story is wrong. She never said any of those things. She never said she was fired. She never said she was too sexy.
Hang on. So we will revisit the story.
Good job, Fester.
And we're going to go straight to the horse's mouth. And this will be sometime around 7:45 this morning.
The biggest part of all of this is this band, what is it called? Screams of Hell?
Sound of Thunder.
Okay, Sounds of Thunder. They have a new song that was released this morning at midnight.
Whoa.
We're going to be the radio world premiere of a heavy metal song. Right, so, and wait till you hear the name of the song.
I stole it from the PD's office.
We're going to put the whole story together. And we'll do it around 7:45, 7:50, somewhere in that vicinity later this morning here on the MJ Morning Show. In the meantime, I got some morons in the news coming at ya. Next, yeah, we got a big giant pile of idiots. The morons are back in a second here on the MJ Morning Show. Don't move. you think? The special music today for the introduction of Morons of the News is the... Do you know what this is? Roxanne, what is this? Any idea what this is, Roxanne? Put your makeup down, please.
And it's the Home Depot music.
It is. It's the Home... We had a Home Depot commercial during the commercial break, and I thought, hey, let's dig up the Home Depot music as our... Because I'd like to try to rotate and put in like a different flair. You know, kind of like I'm working at Bennigan's with suspenders, and I got all kinds of like buttons all over my... You know what I'm talking about? Yeah.
It's so, a fun button is what this
yeah,
is.
Oh, yeah. This is the Q105 fun button right here.
No, this is triggering a lot of guys who are going to be doing yard work all through Labor Day weekend.
By the way, if you go on YouTube, there is an endless loop of Home Depot music that just goes on and on and on and on and on. All right, let's go. Early Morons in the News here on the MJ Morning Show on Q105. Yeah, what do you do, Fester, if you don't like the smell of a cigar that you bought? What do you do? Now, I ask Fester because Fester is the only cigar smoker here on the show. Fester's been known, well, Fester, you've got cigar burns all over the interior compartment of your 2004 Lincoln Town Car.
This is true.
I mean, you've got burn holes in your upholstery. You've got even burn holes in the headliner of the roof of the car. You've got even cigar burns on the A-pillar of the front of your vehicle where, you know, just beyond the driver's door and the windshield, you got the A-pillar there.
Yes.
And you've got even cigar burns on that.
Now, I notoriously...
Which that clearly was you stopping short without a seatbelt. And you, like, having a cigar in your mouth.
No.
Oh, okay.
Holding the steering wheel at 10 and 2, and in my left hand, I had a ridiculously long Churchill cigar, and I made a U-turn, and I rubbed the burnt tip right across the felt A-pillar, and it left its scar forever.
All right, so the question remains, if you purchase a cigar and you don't like the smell of the cigar, and listen, hey, we're in Tampa Bay here, and of course, city of Tampa. Tampa's the cigar city.
Yes.
That's one of the nicknames for Tampa, the cigar city.
The Big Guava is the other one.
Oh, that's true. You know, because Tampa, historically, you know, you go back, we had a huge cigar industry here. We still have cigar companies, not as many as we used to have.
Right.
You know, you got a lot of the old cigar buildings near Ybor and West Tampa.
The big J.C. Newman factory off of north on I-4.
But a lot of those old buildings have been repurposed, and they're now...
eye clinics.
What?
Eye clinics.
I don't know about that.
One of them is
oh, really?
One of them off of Central Florida Eye Clinic.
No, but you have other businesses, design firms that have kind of moved into some of those like older, hip... Yeah, you know, cigar buildings, and have redone them, and some of them are gorgeous. All right, so you buy a cigar,
yes,
and you don't like the smell. What do you do as a cigar connoisseur?
I always buy cheap cigars anyway, so usually they smell like crap. And
I thought, hang on. When I was Grand Marshal of the Night Parade,
yes,
in Ybor,
oh yes,
just this past parade. Was that January or February? That was February.
February.
It was February. All right. So when I was invited by the Knights of Santiago.
That was fun.
It was. It was great. And I was the Grand Marshal, and I really appreciate the Knights of Santiago for inviting me and Joe Gonzalez from Gonzalez Plumbing, for instance, who's big in the organization. You know, I think he was the one that actually nominated me, and the whole group said, yeah!
It's a nomination process?
Yeah, I think so.
What?
So this was back in February, and Fester, you handed me a cigar. Remember, you handed me, did you hand me the
cigar? No, they handed you a cigar.
Oh, I thought,
I would never give you a cigar.
I'm sorry, you're right. Yeah. So I was handed a cigar by one of...
Like the president or the chief muckety-muck of the...
Was it another crew?
No, your crew.
So it was Santiago.
You met like the El Presidente de Santiago.
Okay.
And he gave you a cigar as a gift or a thank you or just here's a cigar.
And then I re-gifted it to Fester because I don't smoke cigars, but Fester does.
So MJ looks at this guy and goes, thank you very much. And then turns to me and goes, here, I don't smoke this crap.
I didn't say that.
Something along
was it a good stick?
It was a great stick. It was a great cigar.
The guy said it was a great cigar.
It was fantastic.
right,
so man, why don't you smoke a cigar and be a man for once? Jesus, please.
But the other five cigars I had wedged in my Rough Rider uniform pocket were like $2 cigars.
Like cheapies?
Yeah. I was like,
how many are you smoking a day now these days?
Six?
No, you don't.
No, I don't.
So again, the question is, let me go back to the question. If you purchase a cigar and you don't like the smell of the cigar, what do? Do you eat it? You just say, you know what? All right, this wasn't a good buy. You just, you know, put it out and you throw it away. Right?
Smell it before you purchase.
Well, it really depends where you are. If you're in a reputable cigar establishment where the owner is there and wants you to be happy, you can say, hey, listen, I really didn't like this. He could probably make a suggestion to get you a better cigar. But if you're buying like the grape flavored cigar off of like the back rack of the Wawa that the clerk has to get,
wait a minute, there's a grape flavored cigar.
You don't know about
White Owl grape.
You don't know about the fruit flavored cigars behind the counter at all these convenience stores.
Yeah. I will be happy to admit that I know very little about cigars. You're telling me there's a grape ape cigar?
I think it's grape. There's cherry.
Some peach backwoods.
Yeah, I mean, there's a
peach backwoods.
Does it really taste like that?
I've never smoked one of those because I think that's crap.
That's disgusting.
But for some people, that's their go-to.
Am I ever going to get to the actual story here?
But anyway, I would probably eat it or maybe say something if I was at a true cigar place.
All right. So the question is, you buy a cigar, you don't like the smell of the cigar, what do you do? So you just heard Fester's answer. Well, this is not what a guy in Detroit did. He lit the store on fire.
Holy crap. They do have lighters everywhere at these places.
And you could easily do it.
A man allegedly set a Detroit store on fire because he didn't like the smell of a cigar that he had purchased, and the clerk refused to replace it. So the guy torches the place.
They probably sell real
torches. Hang on, I can't hear you over the flames. What was that, Froggy?
So they probably
what?
Sell.
Hang on.
It's really hot.
What? I can't hear you.
Neither can anybody else.
What? Okay, go ahead.
They sell real torches at cigar places like that could probably catch something on fire real quick, quicker than a Bic.
I've seen those expensive lighters where it's like a blowtorch. You like click it and it goes... You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's a torch.
The customer allegedly dumped.
I'm doing a little bit more on it. I'm doing an F team investigation on this entire story.
That's a Fester team, right?
Yeah. This is not a classy cigar lounge.
No, this is like
about.
A gas station.
Okay, yeah, that's right.
This is like a convenience store. Let me get to the rest of the story because this is crazy. This is absolutely an insane story. So the customer allegedly dumps a bucket of gasoline inside the gas station convenience store and then set it on fire.
What?
This happened on Tuesday at 5:44 a.m. at a convenience store gas station in Detroit. There is video from the surveillance system. There are photos. It is insane. You can see, hey, Andrew, we got to get this story up on our website. Now, I'm reading the story from WDIV Local 4. And Fester, that's the website you're on right now, correct?
That is correct.
Yeah, click on Detroit, WDIV Local 4. And the video is crazy. You see the guy walking with a bucket of gas. He throws it into the convenience store. And then this is nuts. Look at this. Now, is there audio on this? Turn the Home Depot music off. That's still playing. I don't think there's any audio
this
here.
This is just surveillance audio.
He has a
Home Depot style bucket. It's a gray bucket.
He has a gray 5-gallon bucket that he put gas in. I guess he went to the pump and must have like purchased gas out of the pump and then takes the bucket of gas, walks in the front door of the convenience store, throws the gas inside, and then lights a match and tosses it, and the gas just ignites, and the convenience store is now on fire. The front desk.
Looks like a Burgess face.
The front counter is on fire.
When gasoline lights, it's as a very...
It's flammable?
Well, no, but it's an explosive flammable.
Kind of like that. Or maybe
when
not
you're hurt
that,
in an auto accident,
but,
don't right. let the...
How do we know that it was because of the cigar... Like, okay. How do we know? Was that the straw that broke the camel's back? Was there bad blood prior to
in
that?
In the story, police say the customer was angry because he bought a Swisher Sweet cigar,
right.
Oh. Which are the crappiest of the cigars.
Yeah, what you pay for, right?
It's a real cigar. But don't get me wrong. I mean, Swisher Sweets was the first box of cigars I ever bought. But in hindsight,
did you just say Swisher Sweets?
My first was Garcia Vegas.
You were kind of swishy when you said Swishy Sweets.
I mean, the name is Swisher.
But, you know, they're sweet. Literally, they're sweet.
Like you, yeah. Sounded like you were swishing some stuff in your mouth when you said that.
But the Swisher Sweets, cigar-wise, tastes right. Like crap. So the guy does have a point, but he went to return it, and the clerk's like, no, you bought it. You buy it.
You realize it's a Swisher Sweets, sir.
So it was a dollar.
But the dude was so incensed. The video is crazy. All right, we're going to get the video link up on mjmorningshow.com, and we will have it on the top of the page. You'll see like videos we mentioned on the show, and Andrew's going to post the link to the story because it is crazy. I mean, the guy walks in with a bucket of gas, throws it, then lights it. Man, this is a serious story. Now, no injuries were reported. The clerk is Kareem Kasem. Coming in at number five, I'm Kareem Kasem. All right, so the clerk says he came talking to me about how he bought a Swisher leaf before. He's going to like it's not good. This is like broken English here, but
it's verbatim.
I'm reading this verbatim. This is what the clerk said. He came talking to me about how he bought a Swisher leaf before. He's like to me, it's not good. And everything, and it's has cologne on it. And I told him, maybe boss man, you're the one that's wearing cologne. I mean, this story is nuts. But the guy's in custody. Dude, this is a serious charge. I mean, this is like an arson charge.
Yeah.
I mean, this is gonna get escalated. This guy is gonna do some serious time if he doesn't get some, you know, bonehead soft on crime district attorney in Detroit. This guy's going to do a lot of time because typically arson crimes do carry heavier penalties because of how egregious arson can be and the death and destruction and injuries that you can cause by arson.
Yes.
I can't believe that little bit of gas went up like that.
A little bit of gasoline causes a big
It was like
fire.
A cupful.
Oh, my God. God, so back to my original question. What do you do if you buy a cigar and you don't like the smell of the cigar? You don't go out to the gas pump, fill up your gray bucket with gas, then walk into the convenience store, throw the gas all over the front counter, then light the place up. That's not the way to respond.
He actually spent more money on the gas than it would have been just to buy another cigar.
Oh, those cigars a piece are like 65 cents.
I mean, this is absolutely nuts. All right, folks, I will continue with chunk two of the early morons in the news momentarily here on the MJ Morning Show on a very, very busy Friday. I want to talk about your filth. Show rolling up on 7:02 Friday morning. Fester is on the phone. Fester, anything you want to share with us?
Yeah, hold on.
I just looked.
Froggy, what's wrong?
I need you to let me in the back. I was using the bathroom downstairs. Let me in.
Hold on. Froggy forgot his key pass. Oh, he's locked downstairs. All right, hold on. Stay right there, okay?
Where is he? Can Andrew go let him in?
Yeah, Andrew, I think, are you in the back, Froggy?
Yeah, I'll use the luxury bathroom.
All right, are you in, you're in the back of the building, though, not the front of the building. Okay, Andrew, can you go get Froggy? I'm sorry, buddy. I'm sending it. We're back on the air already. You're late, man. Come on.
What am I working with
today? Jesus.
What we're on the air, Froggy.
I have a bad stomach.
All right. Andrew's on his way. You'll be here shortly.
He's setting things up. I bet. You know what? I'll tell you what's happening. I bet you Froggy is not prepared to do the impression connection, and he's setting things up now for an early exit in a few minutes.
No, that's not it.
Are you sure? Because he was ready yesterday. Raul was ready yesterday.
We were
right?
ready yesterday, and Froggy and I spent an enormous amount of time. And when I say enormous, I mean like 6 or 8 minutes thinking of additional impression possibilities to add to the bucket.
All right, Impression Connection is on the way in less than an hour here on the MJ Morning Show. Okay, Froggy is back in the studio. Dude, do you not have a wallet with a key card?
I left it in the bathroom downstairs, actually.
Your wallet's in the bathroom downstairs?
Yes, I know exactly where it is.
I mean,
you feel like you need to go get it? Because
I absolutely do feel like I need to get it.
Is it on top of like the toilet paper dispenser?
It's on top of the dispenser next to the toilet paper dispenser.
What dispenser is that?
I don't know what it dispenses. I think butt sheets.
Next to the...
God, somebody's going to take it.
Go get your wallet.
We won't be able to concentrate.
Take my card, get back up here, and go.
Go get your wallet. You don't want to leave your wallet in the bathroom.
All right, time me.
You know what this... Okay, we'll time you. All right.
And go.
All right, I started the stopwatch.
Okay, just stop. He's gone.
By the way, this is a 1 minute ticker. Let's see if he can get back before the buzzer.
You know what? I can't listen to this for a minute.
I'll turn it lower.
There we go.
You know what this reminds me of? You know when you hear the stories about police officers that they accidentally leave their gun in the bathroom?
Oh, God.
Those happen. I mean, I've heard stories like a police officer, they go to a supermarket or they're in a Home Depot or something or Lowe's. And I know we've talked about that maybe half a dozen times on the show. It's like, how do you not know that you took your gun out of, first of all, why are you taking your gun out of your holster? Just leave it.
I mean, you drop your britches, can they, take the gun out? I don't know.
By the way, Froggy's got the 15 seconds to get back here.
He's not going
to
be back in a minute. He has to run downstairs. It's a big building.
9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2. That's it.
All right.
All right, Froggy's not back. All right, I said a few minutes ago, if you're a teacher, you got to hear this. Oh, now he's running now. Yeah, it's I stopped counting, but no, you didn't make it. Oh, look, he's literally came in with the dude. You
about under a minute?
No,
you were about a minute and 15 seconds probably. So Froggy just runs into the studio with his wallet in his mouth.
Oh yeah,
after you left it on a surface in a toilet stall
of all the surfaces.
You're right.
My God,
I didn't even realize that
the toilet. Cover.
Hey, did you get him running in on MJTV? Andrew, yes or no?
No.
Why do we always miss the shot?
Well, because you were talking and I had the camera on you.
Yeah, this is an unpredictable show.
Right, but you saw him running down the hall.
Okay, Andrew, thank you.
All right.
Honestly.
I did get him as he came in.
Honestly, we need somebody whose part-time job, minimum wage paid job is to just switch the camera. I mean, we should hire $12 an hour, $10 an hour.
All right, so I said all teachers, you need to hear this. Now, the old excuses of why a student didn't do their homework, I mean, we've heard them all. You know, and one of the silly ones and one of the ubiquitous stories has been, oh, the dog ate my homework, which I think that's become more of a joke. I don't know if that ever really happened.
It probably didn't really happen.
Had to have happened sometime in the history of the world.
But the whole dog ate my homework thing, I think that's become, you know, more of like an urban legend kind of story.
It's a colloquial expression.
There you go. Okay, I'll go with that.
It's a colonial expression.
Hey, Fester, why don't you try to say that again yourself?
It's a colloquial.
All right, now, Froggy, go ahead and try and say what Roxanne just said.
Colloquial.
Mean what?
Colloquial?
Meanwhile, this is from the woman that can't say apocalypse.
Right? Hey, I know.
We all have our strengths,
so
don't we?
You can say colloquial, but you can't say apocalypse.
It's the P's in the A word.
What's the name of that movie? Blank Now. What's the name of it? Say it.
Apocalypse.
Oh my gosh, you can't do it.
All right, do it again.
Apocalypse.
Do it again.
Apocalypse.
It's not a popcalypse. It's not a popsicle. It's apocalypse.
Yes. Just when I see it in my head, it just has a lot of peas and popping peas.
Anyway, I've got a reversal on this student that claims that I don't have my homework because the dog ate it. How about a teacher that claims that her dog ate all of the student's homework that she brought home to grade?
Oh, man.
And there's apparently photographic proof of this. This whole story and photo showed up on a Reddit thread, and it's gone viral. The question is this real or a setup? I mean, there's a picture. You can see it. There's a picture. You got the dog, and the dog is on the floor, all the homework is scattered all over. It's like chewed and shredded. And that's what the teacher is claiming, that she was shocked as her dog just completely chewed and shredded the entire class's homework assignment. Take a look. Is that a Siberian Husky?
It looks like it.
It looks like, does. Yeah, it's a beautiful dog.
Yeah, it's a good-looking dog. And you know, you ever see the Siberian Huskies, like where one eye is brown and one eye is
blue?
Yeah, it's like that. It's like that sports guy that used to be on Channel 28.
Jay.
Yeah, that's right. What was it?
Jay. He had one eye.
No.
Different colors.
Jay
Crawford.
Jay Crawford. Yeah, he had one brown eye and one blue eye.
What?
And then remember Drew Soischer? He only had one cyclops eye in the middle of his head. I'm bringing back some old school names from Channel 28, aren't I? Whatever happened to Jay Crawford?
Jay Crawford took a job with ESPN.
Oh, is he still there?
I don't know if he's still associated with the ABC networks, but he was on ESPN for a long time.
Oh, that's right. Yeah. Anyway, I'm looking at the photo here, and you can see it is all the same assignment. So you can see that all of the pages, they look similar, and man, it is just torn. It's shredded all over the floor. Mm-hmm. It looks like it's in the kitchen, right?
Well, looks like a dishwasher.
I was going to say, it looks like a stainless steel fronted dishwasher in the cabinet in the background. And then there's the Siberian Husky looking right at the camera as the teacher apparently is taking a picture of all of the homework that the dog shredded up and chewed. So this is an example of,
Jeez, hey, man, kid,
this is like a reversal. So the teacher has to go back to school and tell the students, hey, students, the dog ate your homework.
Everybody gets A's.
What's the matter with the dog?
A's.
Was it like peanut butter on it?
That's what I was thinking. Or liverwurst?
No, but little Billy had a slice of pizza for lunch, and
I just don't get why he would start eating paper and tear it up.
Anyway, people are wondering, is this real? Is it staged? Is it set up? We don't know.
Who knows?
It did show up on Reddit. And we will get Andrew, our producer, to post this. Can you get this? Oh, it's already up. All right, if you go to MJ, if you want to see the picture of the cute little Siberian Husky and the shredded homework, if you go to MJMorningShow.com, it'll be in the stories we mentioned on the show. So top of the page, MJMorningShow.com, click on stories we mentioned. And then the videos we mentioned, the guy that lit the convenience store on fire with gasoline because he didn't like the cigar he just bought and the clerk wouldn't give him his money back or give him a new one. We already have crazy crap posted on MJMorningShow.com. And while we're talking about our website, don't forget MJTV, because the entire show every morning is on MJTV. We've got a whole bunch of cameras here in the studio and we're on TV. You can watch us. So from 6 to 10 a.m., we're live. You can watch us live or you can watch the video anytime later on during the day. And if you're listening in the car, just the audio, you can see us on video later on. Just go to MJMorningShow.com and click on MJTV. All right. One other school-related story here, because, you know, you got a lot of students getting ready right now. You got a lot of teachers that are going to school. What is one of the worst things that can be accidentally delivered to a school?
Oh.
One of the worst things that can accidentally be delivered to a school.
Drugs of any kind.
You know, stripper.
Hold on a minute.
Well, hold on.
One at a time.
Sorry.
All right, so you were what?
Drugs of any kind.
You know, that's a good answer. Not what I'm looking for, but good answer.
Fifth answer on the board?
Yeah. All right, so that's a good... All right, Froggy, your answer was what?
Stripper. Stripper Graham.
That's a good answer. That's also not bad as well.
I mean, if she walks straight to the teacher's lounge, what's the problem there?
Yeah.
What if, like, other teachers, they hire a stripper to celebrate another teacher's birthday? Yeah. It's probably not the best environment. All right, Fester, you haven't had a guess. What is one of the worst things that can be accidentally delivered to a... Well, I guess the stripper would be delivered.
She would show up herself.
Hang on. She would be delivered deliberately, and she'd show up herself. All right, so Fester, any idea?
Like, ammunition?
You know what? I'm going to give that to you.
Oh, really?
What? Yeah.
I mean, I don't want to be...
Yeah, but go a step further. What do you need the ammunition for?
Guns?
Yes.
Oh, no.
Box of guns mistakenly delivered to a Delaware County high school in the Philadelphia area.
That's like an instant lockdown, right?
A box of guns was delivered to a Delaware County high school in what cops called an honest mistake. Police said the delivery to Chester High School was a mistake on the part of FedEx. But parents say that it couldn't come at a worse time when schools are obviously laser focused on keeping their children safe, according to NBC Philadelphia. Yeah, probably not a good idea. So here's what happened. Chester Upland School District Superintendent Dr. Craig Parkinson said that they were expecting a delivery of textbooks and supplies for the start of the school year, but instead they open up the box and it's a box of guns. Oh my God. Worst possible thing to show up at a school.
Worst thing ever.
My God.
Ooh, why couldn't they have sent a box of strippers?
Hey, I don't know what's going on, but there is like a rash of issues where clerks are getting attacked, people that work at stores. Is this a byproduct of the pandemic?
I can think of an example of a rash of times that you've used the word rash. Ooh. You keep saying that this week. It's a rash of people in drive-thru windows.
There is a problem where people that work in the service industry, they work in stores, there is just a crazy amount of these people that are getting attacked by nut job customers. All right, hold on. I got a new list of these things in a minute. We'll also do impression connection coming up. Got to clear my throat. It's a loaded Friday. Yes, Fester, you're holding your hand up.
I think the next segment of our show is the most jam-packed segment
it is
we've ever done since we've been back from the morning show.
We have a lot coming up next. We've got impression connection. We have a story that has to be set straight with a heavy metal female vocalist rocker. whose body is so hot that she gets fired from jobs. But that story apparently needs correcting. All right, hold on. You don't want to miss the long MJ Morning Show chunk next here on the MJ Morning Show on Q105. Hey, my friend. Hello, my name is MJ. I've got Roxanne, Fester, Froggy, Andrew the producer. It is 7:24 here on a Friday, and thus commences the extremely long, uninterrupted chunk of the MJ Morning Show. We go for an hour and 20 minutes with zero interruptions, except potentially some bodily noises from Fester. But
I had that ready to go.
Really?
Wow, that was quick.
I would have shut my mic off if you didn't taunt me about bodily noises.
We're 40 seconds into the uninterrupted segment. I get interrupted by Fester. All right, we have a lot of stuff. We have Impression Connection coming up, your chance to call in. I have a revelation. People are stunned regarding something at Walmart. So that's coming up at 7:45. I mentioned the service industry. I mentioned people working at stores. And it just seems that this has increased post-pandemic or just after, like, the lockdown started to open up. It just seems that people have gone nuts. You know, if you missed it, just a little while ago, we were doing Morons in the News at, I don't know, about 6:45-ish or so. And we had a story about a guy that went to a Detroit area convenience store gas station to buy a cigar, didn't like the way the cigar smelled, said to the clerk, hey, can I get my money back or get a new cigar? The clerk said no. And the guy goes out, I imagine, to his vehicle. He grabs a gray 5-gallon work bucket, must have put his credit card into the pump, buys gas, puts gas in the bucket, then goes back into the convenience store and just, this is all caught on surveillance video, takes the bucket and just throws the bucket of gas on the front counter in the convenience store and then lights the place on fire. And it's all caught on surveillance. What is going on with people? And again, the continuation here is leave the store clerks and the workers alone. We have, like, the fast food stories, people like climbing through the drive-thru or climbing over the counter and beating up employees at fast food restaurants. I mean, it's crazy. People that claim that they're in line too long and they're like grabbing the worker through the drive-thru window and grabbing their, like, neck.
Yeah, it's not their fault, people.
They want food now.
I mean, what's going on here? Customer arrested after threatening the staff at a Virginia smoothie shop. Now, what could possibly go wrong at a smoothie shop? Aren't things supposed to run very smoothly at a smoothie shop?
It's in the name.
Maybe the fruit was wrong?
Well, I don't think of angry people at smoothie shops.
When you think of smoothie places, what is one of the national franchises that you see all over the place?
Smoothie King.
That is a good guess, but not what I'm looking for.
Smoothie Queen.
No, Froggy.
Smoothie Prince.
Looking for the Smoothie Transgender.
Ooh. No, I'm kidding. Smoothie.
You know what? That's another one. But nope.
Tropical Smoothie?
Yes!
Oh, good
yes.
One. Yes. Look at you.
It's the Tropical Smoothie Cafe, and this happened in Virginia, and apparently a customer shoved an employee, and it's all over some kind of a disgruntlement. On Friday afternoon, this is last Friday, customer was arrested after throwing what law enforcement officials described as a temper tantrum in a smoothie shop near Fredericksburg, Virginia. 33-year-old Keona Lewis of D.C. was unhappy with the smoothie that she received at the Tropical Smoothie Cafe, threatened to beat the employee's ass who served the smoothie. Come on. What?
Well, you know what? This all of a sudden reminded me of something.
What?
Remember when the guy went into a smoothie store, the dad,
the two
and he was
women?
Like,
that was up in Connecticut. They were high school girls.
Right, because the high school girl put peanuts in his son who had,
well, yes. Peanut butter.
Peanut butter.
So his son had a peanut butter allergy, and he claimed that he told them that my son's allergic to peanut butter. And somehow the peanut butter ended up in the smoothie, and the son goes into, like, anaphylactic shock, had to go to the hospital. I don't know if they went boom with an EpiPen in the kid's leg. I don't know. But then the guy went back and started screaming, and that guy was arrested and was using, like, slurs, right?
He lost his job at, like, some high fancy schmancy financial office.
That's right. The guy was one of the...
Merrill Lynch.
He was it Merrill Lynch? Mm-hmm. He was one of the top, like, brokers in the state of Connecticut, and the guy got fired because of his flip out.
Crazy.
You know what? Glad you brought that up. We seem to have a smoothie theme here with people going nuts. But what could have happened? What could have happened at the Tropical Smoothie Cafe where the customer's unhappy with the smoothie and then it escalates to, I'm going to beat your ass?
I mean, you know, maybe...
That, by the way, that is from the arrest affidavit here.
He could have said something worse.
Seriously, I mean, there could have been not enough strawberries. There could have been too much strawberries. Right,
so
there's really a lot of options.
This woman, Keona Lewis, continued screaming at other staff members, then went behind the employees, start shoving employees. Then before leaving the store, there were four smoothies on the counter, and she did the big old arm swoop and swooped four cups of smoothies across the counter and flung them onto the floor.
Yes.
All across. Oh, and by the way, it wasn't just four smoothies that got then just rearranged all over the floor. Guess what else? 14 snickerdoodle cookies.
I was about to say, that's where they keep the cookie rack, because nothing goes better with a smoothie than a cookie. You get a nice healthy smoothie and a cookie.
Apparently grabbed 14 snickerdoodles and hurled them into the trash.
See, that's just a shame. Those are delicious snickerdoodles.
But I'm just saying that people are going nuts on service workers at fast food restaurants or whatever. Leave them alone. And then there's, before I move on, and I need to get a review from Froggy. Froggy brought this up earlier in the week.
Mm-hmm. What?
And we didn't have time to do it. It kind of fell through the cracks, but I'm really, really interested. Something that Froggy watched on TV, and I want to know what the hell the story is, because Froggy said it, like, said nothing. So hold on.
It was a big con job.
Hold on. Froggy's claiming there was a TV con job earlier in the week. I'll get to that in 1 minute. Hold on. But then... Now, I don't know if we should put this on. I don't know if there's been an arrest yet, but there was video that was released out in Arizona. A woman smashed a Circle K employee in the head with a brick. And then one of her other friends then is walking out with, like, bags of chips. Really? I mean, what is going on? And then once the Circle K employee was hit in the head with a brick, again, caught on surveillance video.
It's all on surveillance. You cannot walk into a gas station or a convenience store and not be on video.
Everything. Everything is on surveillance video these days. Everything. Every home has, like, a camera and a $99 Ring doorbell or whatever. So, Arizona. Circle K employee is bashed in the head with a brick. And then the perp then, and it's a woman. A woman-on-woman issue. And then once the Circle K employee was, like, kneeling on the ground in pain, then the whack job woman grabs her head and starts whacking her head into the ground.
Oh, my God.
And then her friend's, like, walking up with Pringles. And, I mean, it's like, really?
Well, Circle K does have the thirst buster.
All right, just leave these folks alone. Leave them alone, please.
They're a head buster.
All right, Froggy, I don't want you to take too long on this, but I got to be honest. I am intrigued. I am interested. I saw the promos. I didn't see the show, but Froggy, earlier in the week, we were in a break. We were in a commercial break or whatever, and Froggy's like, man, I watched that thing last night, and it was a bust. I felt like I was ripped off.
Froggy, that seems to be the consensus.
You know what I'm talking about, right?
Yeah, Richard Simmons.
You can get skinny! You can get skinny! All right. So, Fox, was it Monday night?
It was
Either Monday or Tuesday.
Monday.
It was early in the week, and Fox had some kind of, was it a TMZ special?
Yeah, TMZ special, what really happened to Richard Simmons.
Because Richard Simmons, like, fell off the face of the earth.
He did.
What happened to Richard Simmons? But we've heard stories that he was, like, kidnapped by his housekeeper or something. Or
he's living in the basement.
He was being held against his will. And I mean, there have been all kinds of stories about Richard Simmons. And
that's how they hoodwinked me in. They're like, is he transitioning? Is he being held captive by his maid? I'm like, what? I gotta watch.
That's one of the stories that's been circulating that he's transitioning.
To a woman, yeah.
which, you know, would be fine, but nobody knows.
It's an awfully long transition.
Yeah.
I mean, Bruce Jenner did it in like 2 weeks.
And then they interviewed Bruce Valanche, and he talks about how he called him and was like, "Are you turning into a woman?" And they're like, and he's like, "No, I'm absolutely not." So he, there goes that.
I'm just tired of seeing people.
So it all came down to he got a double knee replacement, and that affected his exercising, and he got depressed, and he decided to be a recluse. He doesn't want to see people after a lifetime of helping people.
Whoa. All right, hold on. Yes. What procedure?
A double knee replacement,
all right,
I believe.
Now, I read as an aftermath follow-up to this thing, but you thought the show was just like a waste of time.
It was nothing. They showed a bunch of old clips. They went through old rumors. And then at the end, they're like, "Well, it just turns out he had a double knee replacement. He wants to take care of himself for once instead of everybody else."
Hey, I want to dance with somebody.
Yeah, me too.
Hi. Hi, everybody.
So great.
Man, there are some polyester princesses on this video.
Look at all those Karens.
By the way, this is from 1996. This is Party Off the Pounds. This is from the Richard Simmons Party Off the Pounds video.
Is that the mom from Gilbert Grape?
Yeah. I read, though, in the aftermath of the TMZ piece, I read a piece. Did they not bring up the secret birth defect that Richard Simmons allegedly had?
I didn't see anything about a birth defect. Hold on a minute.
The story that I saw was that the reason for Richard Simmons' it says the new documentary, TMZ Investigates, What Really Happened to Richard Simmons, claims the entertainer's been holed up in his Hollywood Hills home due to a painful ailment that he battled since birth. Are you telling me that you didn't see this portion of the show? Would you go to the bathroom?
That must have been when I was getting something for the kids. I must have missed that part.
Or medicating yourself.
Or a restroom break. I missed that part.
Well, the story that I read
was a little head growing out of his shoulder?
The story that I read was he's got a painful ailment that he's battled since birth. Something that happened to him at birth is directly connected to his disappearance. A birth defect that significantly affected one of his legs. TMZ managing editor Fabian Garcia declared in the documentary he was born without a full set of bones in his foot.
What?
And it causes physical and emotional problems. You're telling
me that
you didn't see that part of the show?
That part must have slipped through my mind.
How do you miss? Apparently, it's the pivotal part of the show that he has some kind of bone defect in his foot.
Let me guess. Is it his right foot?
I don't know.
I never noticed.
I'm trying to study his dancing right now, I think he is.
We're watching Party Off the Pounds. We're watching the video on mute while you guys are jibber-jabbering over there. His right foot...
A little slow.
...is completely positioned differently than his left foot.
Yeah.
His left foot's looking at you, and his right foot's like off at 3 o'clock.
It almost looks like his right... We're looking at the Party Off the Pounds video here. It looks like his right foot is like more sluggish than his left foot, right?
And he's kind of shuffling it a little bit. Watch when he goes to his left.
Yeah.
He shuffles it.
It looks like a little more like club footy or something, right?
Yeah.
Froggy, how do you watch the whole documentary and the most important part here you miss?
It's just, I must have forgot.
Well, how's the club foot, or I should say the bones of the foot related to the knee surgery?
We don't think he has a club foot.
Well, the big thing was transgender, no. Being taken by his maid, no. Double knee surgery, yes. I never heard about the club foot or the peg leg or whatever he has.
Your TV show comprehension is...
All I know is that lady right there looks like my best friend's mom.
Froggy's looking at the 1996 video of Party Off the Pounds with Richard Simmons. All right, so you watched the whole damn show, you were let down, and you miss, apparently... the biggest part of the show that he's a recluse because of a bone disorder, a birth defect.
You know how it is trying to watch TV with kids. Faster.
Whatever.
I gotta say, of all the celebrities or people of any kind of fame or notoriety we've ever had the blessing of meeting, I think Richard Simmons was one of my absolute favorite.
He's colored in perfume. He was
such a nice guy.
That's positive energy.
That's a big story here. Now, who just said perfume?
Me.
I was about to just segue into that before we move on away from Richard Simmons.
You can't even enjoy him.
And become reclusive here in a moment. But we had him probably in the studio over the years. Two or three times.
Yeah, like in the mid-2000s, 2005.
I think it was late 90s. I think it was maybe late 90s into early 2000.
Okay.
So I know that he was certainly in the studio when BJ was still there. But Richard Simmons, he would walk in again with those skimpy little shorts. They'd be the striped shorts, either the red and white stripes or the red and blue stripes. He'd wear the same type shorts. He would have like the workout tank top on.
Yep.
And let me tell you now, I have never smelled that much cologne on a human being in my life.
Always
and
in full makeup?
He would insist on hugging everybody.
There was no other way.
Richard Simmons would come into the studio and say, MJ, it's great to see you again. And he'd give me a hug. And his cologne would transfer from his body to my body. And I could not get that reek off of me for weeks. I'm telling you, I smelled like Richard Simmons cologne for like half a month.
I don't know that I've ever seen MJ hug anybody.
Well, it was
except for Richard
Simmons. It was not voluntary.
No, he forced it on you.
He just grabs you and starts hugging you.
There was no option.
Here's a big story on Vanity Fair. TMZ documentary comes to conclusion. He's a recluse because of busted knee. I rest my case.
That's the final answer, but there was also this defect that might have helped. Part of it.
Maybe caused problems in his knees.
Maybe. All this aerobic with chunky ladies. I'd bust up a couple of knees over a lifetime.
How did he be workout king for like 30 years and he's fat the whole time? How did that work?
He wasn't fat.
He wasn't in shape.
He wasn't fat
either. No.
He was never like ripped.
His claim to fame was that he was like a heavy dude like Jared from Subway before he diddled with little boys or... Richard Simmons was a heavy guy. That's how he got like his TV show in the mid to late 70s, or was it early 80s?
But he was probably
80s. So he was a fat kid. He was a fat young adult, and then he lost all this weight, and that was like his launch. And then he got a TV program, and then he did all these like Sweating to the Oldies and Party the Pounds Off.
I heard he made $100 million from Deal-A-Meal cards.
Oh, that's right, Deal-A-Meal.
Yeah. That was like his big...
Oh,
but the thing is, he was never like, get jacked, get six-pack, get yoked up.
No, it was all like light aerobic stuff.
He had great legs.
You know, and like he had a TV show in the videos. He had like 400-pound women jumping around. Seriously.
And then he would talk to them and
you
start crying.
You can get skinny. You can get skinny.
Listen, you can do this, okay? You can.
Hold on a second. I think I still smell like Richard Simmons from 20 years ago.
You know what's been in the news lately? Forever chemicals.
Oh, yeah.
Richard Simmons is like a forever aroma on you.
I just got word. We might get Sheriff Chad Cronister calling right now. Hang on a minute. They just texted me. Good now. Did you hear about the prostitution bust that they announced yesterday?
No.
Yeah. Hey, Andrew, watch the hotline. Yeah, now is good. I just got word that the sheriff has a very busy morning, and he can call us right now. All right, we are live and waiting. All right. Oh, look at that. I guess Andrew, see if that's the sheriff on the line. Do you see one of the details? Now, we don't do a lot of prostitution bust stories on the show, but one of the elements here, is this Sheriff Cronister? All right, folks, let's welcome back to the MJ Morning Show, Sheriff Chad Cronister, Sheriff Hillsborough County Sheriff's Office. Sheriff, welcome back to the MJ Morning Show.
Always a pleasure. Good morning, everyone.
Always great to have you on. So you had the little presser yesterday about this big prostitution bust, 176 people arrested. This was, what, a months-long operation, but one of the details was a honeymooner, a guy on his honeymoon?
Yeah, how do you think that played out? He's on his honeymoon, his new bride falls asleep, and he answers an ad for sex from our undercover operative and shows up.
Oh my God.
Sheriff, do you know where were they from? Were they local or were they from out of town honeymooning here?
No, great question. They were local. They went and got a hotel that night. Like I said, she falls asleep, and he decides, "Hey, I'm going to go pay for sex. Let me answer an ad," and shows up to our undercover detective and tells her what sex acts that he wants. And I was making light of it yesterday. You know, I don't know if the marriage was able to sustain something like this, but I wonder if it was too late for the wedding guests to get their gifts back.
Oh, geez, yeah,
jeez.
For real.
All right, so. You had a months-long investigation and 176 people. Can you give us details? And I guess you were also able to rescue some individuals that were humanly trafficked, correct?
Yeah, this was a four-month operation. I wanted to start it before school let out. And what I wanted to focus on at the beginning was the predators who were preying on our children. So we started that operation online, scouring the web, even the dark web, and we had our undercover posing as a father trafficking his 12-year-old daughter.
Oh, my God.
And we rented a trailer and had these individuals showing up at the trailer paying our undercover to go inside and have sex with his daughter.
So these are men showing up thinking that they're going to have relations with a 12-year-old girl.
It is, and I tell you what, I think the more disturbing one was the gentleman who was communicating back and said, "Listen, again, how old was your daughter?" And they gave the age again and said, "Yeah, too old for me."
Oh.
That is unbelievable. Folks, these operations get these sicko creeps off the street.
Sheriff, what happens to these victims?
The victims are undercovers.
So the victims are undercovers. Okay.
No, but
in general, though.
Yeah, but the victims, we work with Sail of Freedom. We have a great agency that we work with, a non-government organization that provides services, helps us do the interviews. Some of these are recovering victims of human trafficking themselves. Great question. And they'll take the time. A lot of them will suffer from addiction. That's how these traffickers work. They'll take these young, impressionable women, and they'll get them dope sick. And what dope sick is they get them so addicted to drugs
yep.
that the minute they start to become sober, they get so physically ill. And, hey, you want your fix? Get back out there and keep performing these sex acts. So these, like Sail of Freedom, will get them addiction treatment. Obviously, that intense mental health therapy and counseling that they need, housing, gainful employment, they really help them out. And they've been the organization that has helped us rescue these victims. Now, when you talk about what happens to the victims, that's part of it. The two victims that we rescued, the 16 and 17-year-olds,
yeah.
that their family were just worried about, just worried sick, and reported them missing and endangered. These two men trafficked these two kids down here to Tampa. When we caught them, they were already with another individual, and we arrested all three. And
yeah, because you had two teenagers. You had I think what Roxanne was talking about, you had the 16 and 17-year-old girls from Massachusetts that came down to Tampa, and your detectives found them in the process of this investigation, right?
They did, and they will return them back home with their parents, and I can only hope that they're getting the therapy and counseling that they need up there. So hopefully they won't allow anyone to make them a victim ever again. And these other two individuals were teamed up with Homeland Security. We firmly believe that they're trafficking more of these young girls, and hopefully there'll be more to come for that.
All right, Sheriff, thanks for coming on. But again, a guy on his honeymoon, his new bride falls asleep in the hotel room, and he goes online and finds a prostitute?
Yeah, this is what not to do when you get married.
And of course,
men out there, this is what not to do.
And of course, the prostitute was not a real prostitute. It was an undercover sting operation. Sheriff Chad Cronister, thanks for coming on again. I know you have a busy morning. Thanks for finding time to come on.
Have a great day and a safe weekend, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, Thank Sheriff. Thank you.
Oh, while they're doing his perp walk, the sheriff should have thrown rice at him.
You know what? I would. Or if it happened in Pinellas County years ago, it could have been Sheriff Rice throwing rice.
Sheriff Rice in
Pinellas County years ago. Can you imagine? You're on your honeymoon. You're in the hotel. Your bride falls asleep, and you're trying to pick up a hooker online. Oh. And then you leave the hotel room while your wife is sleeping?
And the wife is, I mean, maybe the wife is okay with it. Maybe they're in some freaky couple.
No, I don't think the wife was okay with it.
Honey, thanks for marrying me. I'm going to sleep. Go get yourself a hooker.
All right, that's unbelievable. All right, we have a lot of ground to cover here. We have the Walmart story right now. we've got this crazy item that has developed since we did the story about the woman that claimed that she was twice fired for being too sexy because her body was too shapely. But that whole story has taken a remarkable turn. First, though, people are shocked that Walmart has this. I had no clue. Now, Walmarts have a bakery section.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, yeah.
You've
right.
got the deli section. You got the bakery section. You can get the rotisserie chicken. You can get the mac and cheese. You can get the chicken nuggets, whatever you want. All right. So did you know, according to this woman, a bridal expert, that Walmart's wedding cakes are unbelievably good?
You know, I had Walmart cake one time, and I was like, holy cow.
No, I'm talking about Walmart making.
Yeah.
Walmart can make like a multi-tiered wedding cake that looks like it didn't come from Walmart.
Really?
Yes.
I thought you just meant the taste of the cakes there, which I've had.
Wedding expert named Courtney put pictures online, and she said that wedding cakes are really expensive. Now factor in inflation and all the supply chain issues. Prices are going up for these bad boys. And then she shares pictures of a Walmart cake and said, I really didn't believe it myself. And she's looking at these Walmart cakes starting at $68 for these like impressive multi-tiered cakes. And she's like, holy crap. Do our listeners know that if you need a really good wedding cake that you can have it made at Walmart?
So here, I'm on the Walmart bakery website.
Yep.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5 or 6 different wedding cake. Here's some more. 10, 20 different wedding cake options. Look at this cake right here. 3 tiers, has like the little icing flowers coming down the top.
$68 to $71.
So you that's a hidden talent by Walmart, because you wouldn't think that was their specialty, but do they taste good, apparently.
They look like their cakes that cost $1,000. I mean, these are...
What, do they hire real bakers?
They have real bakers that bake them.
I mean, bakers that like, you know, look like they bake cakes from TV shows?
I had no idea that you could get impressive wedding cakes at Walmart. Oh, I wonder if the honeymooners, I wonder if the guy who was busted in the Hillsborough County Sheriff's Office prostitution sting, I wonder if they had a Walmart cake at their wedding.
Okay, so the Walmart 2-tier cake, I want to be correct here.
Right.
Various styles range from $68 to $71.
Yes.
It's a real big range,
yep.
$3.
Yep.
The 3-tier cakes are $160 to $163.
So how does that, you add the middle layer, it jumps from $71 to $163?
Listen, now it's weird. A triple-tier cake.
But even then.
It's a lot more skill than a double-tier cake.
But even then, these cakes, the pictures look good.
Yeah, they do.
I'm guessing that the cakes probably look like the pictures. You know, sometimes things don't look like the picture. But hey, little public service announcement here on the MJ Morning Show. All right, before we get to the impression connection, and Chloe wants to play, and Chloe's got to do an online exam this morning, so we got to get the show on the road here. We have to, I guess, clean up a little bit of a mess. Now, we didn't create the mess. We just reported something. We talked about a story, and then it turns out that the story's wrong, and through a weird chain of events, Fester ends up talking for 45 minutes with a heavy metal lead singer from... this is a weird, weird story.
Froggy knows. Froggy knows. Oh, when we did the story originally, we said the name, and Froggy's like, is she in a rock band?
Let me read the story. Let me read the headline. We did this. If you're a regular MJ Morning Show listener, then you might remember the story. I was fired twice for being too sexy, but it's just my natural shape. Nina Osegueda, 38, is going viral with a TikTok detailing how she was fired twice for dressing inappropriately, even though it's just my shape. She claimed that she's been body shamed since she was a little girl. You know what? Let me get her on the phone here, and then we'll tell the story while she's on the phone. And then she wants to clean up the story, and then Froggy said, I know that name, Nina Osegueda. I think she might be in a heavy metal band.
And then at first we're all like, oh yeah, it must be a different Nina Osegueda. And then we found out, no, same one.
But
kind
then
of
I,
unique name.
But I remember I said, well, Nina Osegueda is a pretty specific, I don't think that's a very common name.
Yeah. 7 billion people on the planet. It's possible there's, you know, 3 of them.
All right, let me get Nina Osegueda on the phone. 1-301. So we're calling Maryland here.
Yep, she lives in the D.C. area.
All right. And apparently the story that the New York Post had was riddled with inaccuracies.
Hello.
Good morning. Is this Nina?
It sure is.
Nina, welcome to the MJ Morning Show. I'm MJ, and of course you spoke to Fester last night. Roxanne, say hello.
Hi, Nina.
Hello.
And Froggy.
Hello, Nina!
No. What do you think of that?
No, Nina, Froggy knew your heavy metal band. When we mentioned your name, he was like, I think that's a lead singer of a heavy metal band. I'm like, get out of here. No, she's not.
And none of y'all believed me for the longest time.
And now it turns, Nina, you are the lead singer of a heavy metal band.
That's very true. I'm glad he knew that more than the other things.
Wait, what? This
is incredible. What's the name of the band?
It's A Sound of Thunder.
A Sound of Thunder?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And how long have you guys been a band?
We've been a band for about 13 years.
Wow. And Froggy, how were you exposed to Nina's band, A Sound of Thunder?
I just came through it on a Spotify shuffle one day, and I enjoyed your voice. I like female leads with a metal sound. It's like the perfect sound for me.
All right, so
she's
Nina,
got a great voice.
Nina, where did this story come from the New York Post, that you claim, or the headline was, I was fired twice for being too sexy, but it's just my natural shape. So you want to correct the story from the New York Post. Just set it all straight.
Okay, so this is what happened. There was a TikTok trend where this lady said, what's something that you've learned? And I went on TikTok, and I was like, oh, I learned that even though I dress professionally, you know, I distract people with my shape. And that's all I said. That's literally all I said. And that went viral because I was wearing this, like, cute little dress, and I guess everybody liked the dress, and it went viral from there. And then it went so viral that I explained the story of what I was talking about. And the story of what I was talking about is that when I was in my 20s, I was laid off from a job, and the guy laying me off told me that I was wearing inappropriate clothing. And I wasn't. I was wearing, you know, knee-length dresses and, you know, no cleavage and everything. And I let it go because I was in my 20s and I thought he was just being a jerk. But then I was working another job a couple years later, and the manager of the office I was working at told my coworker that I was wearing a club dress to work, and I was wearing a uniform.
Right.
And it was, again, a knee-length skirt, no cleavage, and I even showed the picture of the dress that I was wearing on TikTok to everybody, like, this is crazy.
So what was wrong with that coworker? Were they jealous of you? Why were they trying to get you in trouble?
God, I don't know. I think that lady was crazy. The coworker who told me about it was actually cool. Like, he was upset for me. He was another office worker, and he told me about it. He was like upset for me, but the old lady who was saying this, like, I don't know what her issue with me was, but again, like, the only thing that in common that these two outfits had was me. The two dresses were like, the outfits were different, but like, I never wore anything inappropriate to the office, so the only thing I could think of was, oh, it must be my big butt. And so I wore a dress that showed off my big butt in the TikTok. And I was like, oh, it must be my shape. And that's all I said. I never said I was sexy. I never said I was fired. And then the New York Post comes up with this headline, like, oh, she said she was too sexy, and that's why she was fired.
Fired,
and I'm like,
twice.
What the heck are they talking about?
Well, all right. So now it's been set straight, ladies and gentlemen. Nina, talking to you, you sound like this sweet woman. I would never guess that you're the lead singer of a heavy metal band called A Sound of Thunder. And folks, unbelievably, today you guys just dropped a brand new song?
We did. Yes, we did. We just dropped our newest single from our new album.
And I love this. Hang on a minute. So you hear how sweet Nina sounds? Nina, what's the name of the new song?
Beach Murder Party.
The name of the song is Beach Murder Party.
Yeah. Rules.
All right. Now, we've got some Beach Murder Party here. This could be your first radio airplay.
Oh, it's not.
Oh, it's.
I'm glad we're having some airplay today. But no, man, no.
Is this the first time Murder Beach Party has been played?
Oh yes.
Okay, that's what he meant. This is the world premiere of Murder Beach Party.
Well, what I'm asking, has any other radio station played Beach Murder Party yet?
Oh hell no! No, you guys are the first.
Yeah, that's what I was saying.
Yeah.
All right.
Oh yeah.
All right. So hold on a minute. I've got the whole song, which I don't know if I'm going to do all 3 minutes and 57 seconds. But I do have the hook. Is there a hook?
Oh yes.
All right. Hold on. Sure is. All right. Hang on. Let's listen here. Hang on. All right. We're listening. This is the intro of Beach Murder Party. Man, I can't wait to hear. I haven't heard this yet. I can't wait to hear what her lead vocal sounds like. How long's the intro on this, Nina?
Not very long.
All right. All right, hang on. Vocal coming up now?
Not yet. My guitarist has to make himself known.
All right, hang on.
Just let it play, man.
I'm letting it play. Here's Beach Murder Party on the MJ Morning Show. It's the Beach Murder Party. Nina.
Oh, yeah.
Nina, your voice is great.
Thanks so much.
You're like the sweetest heavy metal rocker female I've ever met.
Oh, thank you so much. I appreciate that.
Now, what is your real job? What do you do for a living?
I'm a graphic designer.
Oh, fantastic. Like, what do you graphically design?
Well, I work for a school. That's my day job. And at night, I'm a heavy metal singer. And because I'm a graphic designer, I do all of our layout for the band. So we get to do that for free.
That's great. And do you guys tour?
Oh, yes. Yeah, we've been to Europe. We actually went viral in Europe a couple years ago. So we've been to Europe a couple of times. We've toured the U.S. We're an independent band. We have no label. We do everything ourselves. We've raised over $300,000 on Kickstarter to fund all of our albums. So we are totally DIY.
Wow, man. I could just hear this coming out of like a Q105 jingle. Like, hang on a minute. Heavy metal.
All summer long, Q105.
Here's Beach Murder Party. Great. Hey, Nina, great having you on.
Thank you so much for having me. I really appreciate it.
Nina, we'll keep in touch with you. And let us know if you're going to tour Tampa.
Oh, will do. Absolutely. I'd love to go.
Nina, we'll keep in touch. And Fester said that you were delightful, that you spoke with him for like 45 minutes last night. So.
Oh, yeah. It was a good time.
Nina, have a great weekend.
Thank you. You too. Bye-bye.
Look at that. All right, all cleaned up.
Yeah.
So it just shows, like, her viral video then sparked the story, and the story was kind of presented in a way that was not factual. So now
that happens. Yeah. And New York Post, or as so many online publications do, they love to use their words creatively. Ooh, too sexy for work.
Yeah. Oh, look what time it is. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time for the Beach Murder Party edition of Impression Connection. Ladies and gentlemen, here's Hal Herman.
It's really froggy.
Hal, come on down.
All right, here we go. My name is Hal Herman.
How are you not in a heavy metal
band? Thank you. I just heard a heavy metal singer, and I thought I'd show you some of my pops. My name is Hal Herman. I could sing death metal too.
All right.
What? What do you think about that?
I don't want Hal Herman singing death metal.
Okay.
All right, folks, let's go fire up the phones. This has turned into a fan favorite. It's Impression Connection.
Yes.
And in fact, Chloe wants to play. Let's go. Hit the phones right now. It's been a while since we played. 800-990-1047. You call us up. You decide who you want to play with, either Roxanne, myself, MJ, Fester, or Froggy, and they will reach into a bucket, pull out a slip of paper with a celebrity name.
Yeah, yes.
Not reveal the name yet. They will then do an impression of the celebrity, and you on the phone, you have to guess who the celebrity impression is. It's Impression Connection. Let's fire up the phones right now if you want to be a contestant. 800-990-1047. 800-990-1047. Good luck from the MJ Morning Show. All right, now.
Yes, good luck, everybody.
Yeah. All right, I'm going to call Chloe first because Chloe, my daughter, wants to play. So I'm going to make her the first contestant. Hey, Chloe?
Yeah.
Guess what time it is, Chloe?
Is it Impression Connection time?
It is Impression Connection time. Say hi to Frog. I'm sorry. Say hi to Hal Herman.
Hi, Hal Herman.
How's it going, Chloe? Good to hear from you.
Thanks.
How are things?
Hey, Chloe, what time do you have to do the online exam?
In 25 minutes.
All right. Oh, we better hurry up here because are you all studied up? Are you ready for this thing?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So, Chloe, you know how Impression Connection works. So, Chloe, you're the first contestant here. Chloe's begging to play the game. So, Chloe, the question is, which one of the crew do you want to choose to play with?
I'll go with you, Dad.
Whoa! All right. So,
That's sweet.
Froggy's
here.
I'm sorry.
Shake it up.
Hal Herman is handing me the Impression Connection bucket.
There's a lot of celebrities.
Which happens to be a Coors Light beer bucket.
No, it's an Impression Connection. Look at that.
You went out to the bar.
I'm sorry. Hang on a minute. Let me spin it around. I'm showing it on MJ TV right now. All right. Yeah, there we go. Impression Connection, Coors Light. All right. I'm reaching in. Chloe.
Whoa.
I'm grabbing a name out of the bucket, and let me look at the name, and it is...
Don't say it. Why would he say it?
All right, here we go. You ready?
All right.
Here it is. Here is my impression. You guess the celebrity, and... The hell was that?
Michael Jackson.
What?
That is correct! What's the matter with your voice?
I can't do it that high.
This MJ is not as talented
to
do the other MJ.
But wait a minute. But Chloe, even just going, even with like a bad high-pitched squeal, Chloe still just got it.
Chloe's the queen of the impression.
I'm holding up the slip of paper right now to MJ TV.
Let's be honest. Okay. That was an easy one.
Yeah, I mean, let's stop kissing Chloe's ass like she's
not. Maybe give her another one.
Easy impression.
How come you get the easy one?
Oh, I ought to do
one. It's all random.
All right, it's random.
Put your fat hand back in that bucket.
And then my next thing was going to go, hey, Bubbles. Hey, or hey, Doc. Can you shoot me up with some propofol? I want to take a nap.
You should have done that first.
Yeah. All right. Yeah, Michael Jackson, great. All right, Chloe. I have one more. I will do one more.
Please.
Reaching in the bucket here. And folks, you can watch us on MJTV do this. If you go to MJMorningShow.com, the whole show is on video. We're live all morning long in the studio. MJTV, just click on the MJTV button on MJMorningShow.com, and you can watch us live, or you can watch it back, because all of our shows are archived after the fact, so you can watch the video anytime you want. All right, here we go. Chloe, one more chance here to see if we can do a daily double. Oh, boy. Okay.
Is this one a little more difficult?
I don't know if she's going to get this one.
Oh, good.
That's the point.
If I can turn back time.
Oh, my God.
Yes.
What?
Go. Keep going. Keep going.
I don't know any more of the words.
Give us another one.
I got you, babe.
Oh, my God.
That's not the person.
What?
That's
terrible.
No, that's... But it's the female side of that.
I know, so you're impersonating the wrong person. You can't take the easy one.
If I can turn back time. Oh, hold on a minute. Do you believe in love after love?
Oh,
what?
It's
Cher. It's Cher.
Yes!
Yes!
That was the worst impression I've ever heard.
Worse than mine.
When MJ has to resort to doing a Sonny Bono impression, that gets you to understand that it's Cher.
Chloe, get prepped for your test. Look at that. Chloe.
Good job. Two for two for the closer.
Chloe gets both of them. Chloe, the first contestant on Impression Connection today. All right, bye, Chloe.
All right, bye-bye. Have fun.
Bye, Chloe. What was that shared?
My lovely daughter, Chloe. By the way, a couple of good videos of late with Chloe on my Instagram. Check it out at Certified MJ Radio. Certified MJ Radio. If you didn't see Chloe with the snail in our driveway on the wall, check that out. She wants it as escargot. So Certified MJ Radio. All right, let's go. 800-990-1047. So if you want to play Impression Connection, 800-990-1047 is how you get in. And keep in mind that when I go to a call, if the caller doesn't get it, we go to the next call. All right, so let's grab, how about Joe? Wow, we're going out of state. First contestant is Joe in Salisbury, North Carolina. Hello, Joe, you're on the MJ Morning Show.
Wow, tough act to follow.
Yeah, how about that? All right, Joe, who do you want to play with? Which one of us?
I want to pick Mr. 813-310-8444, please.
That's right. Lance Bander. Right, everybody knows his number.
We know him.
That's Fester.
That's right, baby.
Hey, do you have Fester's number? 813-310-8444. All right. That's Fester's cell phone number, by the way, folks. All right. Go ahead, Fester. Pick one up.
I got one.
Oh, God. Here we go.
All right, Fester is, I don't know what it is, so no. Fester, you have the celebrity name, do the impression, go.
No. Joe, you are a rude, thoughtless little pig, and I'm going to come out there for the day to set you straight.
Wow.
I can tell you right now, at no time did I pull that trigger. The gun just went off in my hand. I have no idea.
Okay. I have no idea. Joe, do you have any idea?
What else does he have to do?
Joe,
No.
Joe, who is Fester impersonating?
I believe he's impersonating Rachel the Flying Tomato.
Okay.
What? Are you drunk?
All right, Joe. Goodbye, Joe.
All right, nope.
He doesn't know.
All right.
Okay. And I want to leave a message for you right now.
Here we go. Listen.
Because again, it's 10:30 here in New York on a Wednesday. And once again, I've made an ass of myself trying to get you a phone to call you at a specific time. When the time comes for me to make the phone call, I stop whatever I'm doing and I go and I make that phone call at 11 o'clock in the morning in New York. And if you don't pick up the phone at 10 o'clock...
All right, that's it. You're a rude, really thoughtless little pig.
Wait, you knew all the words to that, almost exactly.
I've been doing morning radio for a while. I've heard that 1,000 times.
Now we go to the next contestant. We go to the next caller.
But you just gave him the answer.
Well, no, we didn't give the answer away.
We put it in context.
A little bit of context. So that obviously opened up a line. 800-990-1047. 800-990-1047. If you want to play Impression Connection. The next caller to play is Anna in Tampa, who picks up where Joe left off. Anna, welcome to the MJ Morning Show. Hi.
Hi. How are you guys?
We are well. So, Anna, Fester, take it away.
Hilaria, would you please stop using that fake accent around the house? Damn it, I'm just going to call you Hillary.
All right, so
I'm tired of it already.
Now,
how many damn children are we going to have? You know, I'm almost 70. I'm going to be dead soon. You're going to be stuck raising all these little kids yourself.
It's like he's here.
All right, so Anna, cumulatively with what he did with Joe and now you, who is the celebrity?
Is he doing Alec Baldwin?
Yes! Yeah! How did the first guy not get it?
That is Alec Baldwin. You got it.
Very good.
Now, do we give her a chance to pick her own, though?
I think we should. I mean, this is kind of Joe's go.
But I think we kind of, didn't we establish that
prior?
We
kind of
need to get these rules established before
we made that
play.
A rule.
Now, if you guess correctly the previous failure, then we'll give you even another chance fresh.
That's fair.
Anna, who would you like to play with?
How, please?
How?
Oh, so Anna wants to play with Froggy Hal Herman himself.
So is it Froggy or Hal?
Froggy is Hal. Hal is Froggy.
Hal, you can put the fake microphone down.
You let the show come to you.
How am I going to talk then?
All right, go ahead.
Okay, here we go. You ready?
All right, Froggy or Hal Herman is picking out out a celebrity name here.
Okay. Oh, boy.
All right, here we go.
Are you ready?
Yes.
I'm Brian Fellows. Is that a Walmart truck?
Oh, that's terrible. Do you want me to?
Can I get a little more?
Ladies and gentlemen, now a monkey. Hello. I'm Brian Fellows. Oh my gosh, what's coming at us? A Walmart truck!
As funny as that was, I don't know.
What the hell's your problem?
I'll give you a clue. It wasn't funny.
Hey!
Alright, the Walmart truck bashing into him. That's pretty disturbing.
How do you not know who it is, though? I'm trying to tell you who it is exactly.
Alright, so Anna, you do not know.
No, unfortunately.
Anna, I'm going to get you pregnant. That's one of the things he always says.
I don't think Anna knows. Anna, you got Alec Baldwin, but you didn't get the one for you. But thanks for playing, Anna.
I'm exhausted.
Thank you.
Anna in Tampa, thank you so much. All right, let's grab Brian in Tampa. Brian, you're next on the MJ Morning Show. Brian, you get to pick up. Do you have any idea who Hal Herman just impersonated?
I'll listen to it again, but I don't have any clue.
What's your name?
Brian in Town and Country, Tampa.
My name's Brian Fellows. Hey, Liz Lemon, I'm going to get you pregnant.
Liz Lemon?
Okay, come on. I used to work with Alec Baldwin.
All right, so Brian, you have no idea.
I have no idea.
Oh, that's true. Alec Baldwin was on that show as well. All right.
Put this thing in the bucket.
All right, thanks.
Faster!
Thanks for trying to play, buddy. I appreciate it.
How do you people not know this?
Let's grab Jayla. Jayla's in Lakeland. Jayla, you're on the MJ Morning Show. Do you know who Froggy Hal Herman is trying to impersonate?
Absolutely not. I've been listening, and it's either Hal sucks at doing impersonations, or I'm just lost.
All right, hold on. Let's review. All right, our special guest today, a squirrel.
A squirrel. A squirrel's on the Brian Fellows show.
Okay,
I'm losing the voice now.
All right, now go ahead and do the more recognized huge hit that he was on NBC for years.
Hey, Liz Lemon. I work with Liz Lemon. I'm an actor on the show. I have chains around my neck. I got a car crash from Walmart.
Hold on. Any idea?
I see.
I hate me.
Did you say, Donna, did you say iced tea?
Yeah, she did.
Yeah. No. I used to be on SNL.
IC, whatever he played on the NCIS.
It's not IC. No. All right, and I think he's on. I think he's on Law and Order.
She's thinking of LL Cool J.
Hey, Jayla, thanks for playing. Incorrect. Oh my.
Professor, can you do an impression of this guy? Can you help me out?
I would have done the same thing you did.
Yeah, me too.
I might have done it funnier, but the same thing.
Are we going to be stuck on this one? All right, let's grab. How about Jack in Bradenton? Jack. You're on the MJ Morning Show, Jack. Do you know what Froggy Hal Herman is trying to do?
I've been sitting in my car screaming it out, so I think I do.
Who is it?
Tracy Morgan.
Finally.
Thank you.
That's how it goes.
Thank you.
That was ridiculous.
Yeah, because on Saturday Night Live, he did that Brian Fellows.
Was it
Animal Planet with Brian Fellows or whatever the hell it was?
Well, right. I got the Liz Lemon 30 Rock connection.
There you go. And of course, Tracy Morgan was one of the stars of 30 Rock for years on NBC.
And the Walmart truck. Yeah. I thought that would have
gotten. And then, unfortunately, he was rear-ended at like 80 miles an hour by a Walmart truck. At exit 9 on the Jersey Turnpike. And listen, his friend didn't make it, man. So
I know. And Froggy's mad at me about that.
His back was all frigged up. And,
but he's okay now.
And he has sharks in his home aquarium.
Yes. All right. And my friend Basil's sitting there texting me, it's Tracy Morgan, damn it. I can't get through on the phone.
Everybody knows it.
So, Jack, now you get to pick your own. Who would you like to play with?
Let's give Roxanne a try.
Yeah!
The queen of the impression.
Roxanne. All right.
Hey, can't just start spitting facts about the person. Yeah,
Roxanne
like what Hal just did.
Is reaching in. Roxanne, anything you want to say to Jack here?
I like it rough.
Oh, very good.
Yeah, I was going to start with that, Jack. Jack, you did a good job picking me because we're going to get this.
All right, go ahead.
All right. Let's hear an impression.
Luke, I'm your father.
What the?
All right. Do I have to guess? Am I guessing?
Are you okay? Hold on. What's happening?
Is that you? Well, that's not.
Are you hyperventilating? No. Is that part of the impression?
Roxanne.
Are you okay?
Roxanne, it's more like. Yeah, that's
about to pass out.
But that's not who.
You can stop. You're going to pass out.
All right, you're right. All right, who do you think Roxanne is trying to impersonate?
So I know the character, but you want the celebrity's name, right?
It could be the character. In this case, it could be the character.
Come to the dark side.
I'll give you both then. It's James Earl Jones or Darth Vader.
Let's go with Darth Vader.
Yeah. There you go.
Right. Roxanne, that was spectacular.
And of course.
Roxanne having an asthma attack.
It was either Darth Vader or an asthmatic, one of the two.
That was the most pathetic Darth Vader breathing that I've ever heard.
And when she goes, Luke, I am your father.
It's a lot harder for a woman to imitate a man than vice versa.
Well, hold on. Do the breathing again. No. Do the breathing you tried. Do the...
You're not a 9 months pregnant.
Yeah. Okay. It's not Lamaze.
Yeah. Yeah, and of course, the breathing would be...
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the noise you want to make. And of course...
Gosh, sounds like you're on a ventilator.
No, it sounds like she's at the dentist and they're using that straw-sucking device to get the spit out of your mouth.
Does he sound like this?
All right. So, of course, that the voice of Darth Vader is James Earl Jones. Yes. But it was it Alec Guinness that actually was inside the costume?
I don't know.
Really tall guy.
Was it Obi-Wan Kenobi?
Yeah, I'm sorry, who was it?
Sir Alec Guinness was Obi-Wan Kenobi.
Okay, I'm sorry. Then who was
super tall guy?
Yeah, who was the? I'm sorry. Yeah, I mean.
Oh,
yeah.
Who gives a turkey? Anyway,
it wasn't James Earl Jones. Anyway, just a voice.
Congratulations, Jack. You got both, Jack.
Thank you.
Yeah, nice teamwork.
Thanks for playing. All right, that opens up a line if you want to play Impression Connection. 800-990-1047. 800-990-1047. If you want to play Jack's line, Jack's line is now taken, but that's how you get in. 800-990-1047. Yeah, Andrew.
Yeah, the actor's name, I don't remember his first name. His last name was Prowse.
Okay. Interesting. Oh, thank you. All right, let's grab Brittany in Tampa. Brittany, you're on Impression Connection on the MJ Morning Show. Welcome.
Hi, thank you.
Brittany.
Which of the MJ Morning Show members would you like to play with this morning?
Well, I got to go with MJ. I think Chloe picked you by default because you're bad. So.
Yeah, it's true. I thought the same thing, Brittany.
All right, guys. Be very, very nice when you're talking to Brittany.
Leave Brittany alone!
Okay, all right, here we go.
Let me pass you the bucket of impressions.
All right, I've got the bucket. I'm pulling out a name, and I have it.
Let's do this, Brittany.
Oh, boy. All right.
Oh, boy.
My girl wants to party all the time. My girl wants to party all the time.
What the hell?
That's terrible.
I want you to know when I wrote that one, I really was like, how are we going to do this one?
That is fantastic.
Is that great?
Fantastic.
That was really good.
This name was so on the bubble for me. Right. I was like,
We contemplated it for a while. Like,
my girl wants to party all the time. Woo! Right. Brittany, who am I impersonating?
Probably not what I would have chosen, but Eddie Murphy.
Yes! Oh! What do you mean? What else could he have done?
Okay, smart aleck. What would you have chosen?
I would have chosen Roxanne.
All right, now I have a whole repertoire. So if you did not get Party All the Time, I was gonna do something like, oh, I'm not gonna fall for the banana in the tailpipe. All right. Or well, how does his laugh go? He's like, right?
Right.
She got it.
All right, Brittany, congratulations. Wow. You got it, Brittany. Thank you.
You're really good at this game.
Thank you.
All right, Brittany, have a great weekend, okay? And thanks for listening to the MJ Morning Show.
Thank you. You too.
MJ's 3 for 3, by the way.
That's pretty good.
Phones are... Hey, do we have any Party All the Time? Do you have any...
Come on, let's crank this party up.
Come on, Andrew. Give me some Eddie Murphy.
Eddie Murphy music.
And you're going to have to... You're going to have to fast forward it in, because that song has a 52 in...
Yeah,
it's got a 52-second intro. Yeah, here we go.
Yeah.
My girl wants to. All right, go to the hook. Just move it into the hook if you can. My girl wants to.
Party all the time. Party all the time. Party all the time. My girl wants to. Party all the time. Party all the time. Party all the time.
Girl.
All right, let's go back to phones.
That was fun.
Man, this is like a flipping psychedelic shroom party here.
Yeah, that was awesome.
All right, let's go to Lisa in Spring Hill. Hey, Lisa, you're on the MJ Morning Show. Good morning.
Good morning.
Lisa, which one of the MJ Morning Show crew do you want to play with?
You.
No.
Hold on. You're picking me, MJ, again?
I am.
All right. Man, I am popular today. Sometimes when we've played this, I'm like the outcast, you know?
Seriously.
All right, here we go.
So
and
far this morning, I understood yours all the way.
Yep.
Good thinking.
All right, here we go. All aboard!
I have no clue.
Come on, you got to give a little more.
Oh, hang on a minute.
All aboard.
All aboard?
Oh,
I'm
speaking to I'm on the phone now and I'm talking to Lisa and Sharon.
Wait, do
you have any idea who I'm doing?
I was thinking Nancy Pelosi for 1 second.
That's right. Oh, my God. That's fantastic. Right.
Like, guess what? 10 texters know what it is, so you're doing something right. Keep it going.
Are you okay, sweetheart?
I think that's all I have, though.
What? It's the most impersonated person ever.
Can you do something heinous on stage?
No. Bite the head off a bat or something?
Don't talk about it. Do it.
Ozzy Osbourne?
Yes!
He just said that. You say it. You're sitting there going, oh. You know nothing.
Yeah, MJ literally has a convulsion for you. And you don't get that, Lisa.
All right, I tell you what. If you're watching MJ TV, this has got to be some crazy-looking stuff this morning.
Jeez.
And if you're not watching live, you can watch MJ TV later on MJMorningShow.com of today's show. All right, hey, Lisa, have a fantastic day.
And you too. Take care.
All right, thanks. All right, phones are loaded here.
Still 4 for 4, this guy over here. He's kicking our butt.
Let's grab John in Tampa. John, you're on the MJ Morning Show. Hi. John, you got to John, turn your radio all the way down. I'm not going to wait for it. So, Andrew, John's on one. Oh, again, I'll grab another John. John's in Bradenton. Hello, John. You're on the MJ Morning Show. Hi.
Good morning.
All right, John, Impression Connection. Who do you want to play the game with?
I think I'm going to go with Froggy this morning.
All right.
It's not Hal Herman. It's Froggy asked for. Yeah.
Hey, guys. How you doing?
I'm sorry. I would like Hal.
Froggy, get out of here. All right.
Now Hal's back. All right. Go.
Froggy.
All right. Reach into the bucket and pull out a name, Froggy.
Whoa. Okay. Here we go.
All right. Pull it out, and here we go. Do the impression.
All right. Here we go.
Hey, listen, I'm over here now, okay? Hey, you made me put your head in a vice for that idiot! Hey.
I love it.
Hey, I'm a lawyer. Hey, what's a grit? You know what I'm saying? hey, I've been in a bunch of gangster movies, you know?
John, do you know who it is?
Absolutely.
What, am I funny? Hold on. Funny like a clown? Like I'm here to amuse you?
Let him give the answer. All right, John, who do you think it is?
Hey, I'm talking over here. It's Joe Pesci.
Yeah, you prick you.
John's impression was better than yours.
I can't do Joe Pesci, but I try. What is a grit?
The caller just kicked your butt with the impression.
I've been a game show host for years. I don't work on impressions.
Right. Hey, John, thanks. Appreciate it. All right, what about the other John? Is he back? I think we got the other John.
Did you put the name back in the bucket or did you throw it away?
No, John, that was the first one for John.
He got it.
Right. Froggy put the name.
I think it's back in there, but it's okay.
All right, Froggy put Joe Pesci back in the bucket.
No, it doesn't go back in the bucket.
I know, he doesn't. All right, pull it out.
The other John who had the radio cranked up and he was hearing the delay. John, are you back with us?
What about the other John?
Oh, my God.
Turn your radio down. Oh,
Jesus. Hello?
All right.
Now John's hung up.
There's two rules. One, be on a handheld phone. Two, shut your radio off.
Yeah, listen to the show over the phone because that's actual real time because we operate on about a 20-second delay. All right, let's grab Katie in Largo.
Oh, Katie.
You're on the MJ Morning Show. Katie, welcome.
Good morning.
Katie, would you like to play Impression Connection?
Oh, my God, yes.
And which of the MJ Morning Show team members would you like to play with?
Roxanne.
Yay! Oh, so, Katie, winning isn't as important to you as it is to some of the contestants.
Let's try.
She just wants to have fun.
Let's have a little confidence. Roxanne, you did great last time.
There you go, kid.
Roxanne is reaching to the bucket. She's pulling out a celebrity name on the piece of paper. Okay. And Roxanne, hit her with the impression. Go. Oh my God.
What the hell was that?
What the hell?
What are you, a Martian? That was a dumb
question.
What was it?
What did you say?
R2-D2.
What?
Is that right?
Yes.
Oh my God.
I can do the rest of the show like that if you want.
That was R2-D.
She's walking like a robot at the same time.
She's actually making more sense.
Holy moly, Katie, that is incredible. All right, Katie, thanks.
That was quite astounding.
That was some teamwork, Katie.
Katie, thanks for playing. Have a great weekend.
Oh, wow. Thank you.
Froggy, it was nothing like that. Hers was really good.
All right,
okay,
hold on.
R2-D2? Okay.
All right, Froggy, hang on. Roxanne, do it again.
I'm going to pee my pants.
Hold on. We got a new ISO. I'm going to pee my pants.
Liar, that liar. All right.
Pull that one. All right, go ahead.
You can't laugh. She's making beeps.
All right, let me go back to phones.
My God, that was amazing.
Everyone loves this, man. The phones are loaded. 800-990-1047. Let's grab Jeanette in Tampa. Hello, Jeanette. You're on the MJ Morning Show. Hi.
Hi, good morning.
All right, who do you want to play the game with?
Let's go with Roxanne again.
Oh, yeah.
Look at her. Confidence is building.
Oh, yeah. We're rolling now.
Roxanne, you still have the bucket, right?
I have the bucket.
Okay. All right, Roxanne, pick out another name, do the impression, and let's see if Jeanette knows who you're impersonating. Go.
Okay, I got a good one.
Okay.
Adrian, in real life, I'm going to knock you out.
Jesus.
Hold on. What'd you say?
Rocky.
Yes.
That was the worst.
Are we looking for Rocky? Are we looking for his real name?
We're looking for the character.
Okay. Yes, thank you.
Sylvester Stallone
yes.
is correct. Wow.
Because I'm about to get divorced. Hey.
Now, I was going to go with that, but I was like, what's her name? Jennifer Flavin. Yes, Jennifer Flavin.
Now, what I would have done, though, is you did do the Adrian. I would have, Adrian.
A longer yo at the beginning of that.
I would have done
really
a yo, but
it.
Listen.
Okay.
But
also, you could have gone, I feel like a Kentucky Fried Idiot, Mick. You know what I'm saying?
So, Jeanette, you got it. Congratulations. Thank you.
Yes.
Roxanne. For some reason, her impressions are turns. And people keep getting them.
One of her impressions were...
How many more names are in the bucket? Can we keep going here?
Of course. We got plenty.
All right. 10 more names?
All right, let's grab... More. How about Steve? Steve is in Spring Hill. Hey, Steve, MJ Morning Show, welcome.
Good morning. How are you?
We are well. Steve, which one of the crew do you want to play the game with?
I'm going to go with that Hal Herman.
Oh, man. Wow. Another Hal Hersky.
All right. Give Hal Herman the bucket.
And all right.
Reach on in, Hal, and pick out the name and do the impression and go. Here we go.
Oh, well. Hey, I pity the fool who don't eat my cereal. I wear a bunch of chains around my neck, and I was in WrestleMania 3. Who am I?
That's Hulk Hogan.
Man, you're a dummy. I pity the fool that called me Hulk Hogan.
It's not Hulk Hogan.
You're stupid, man.
Stop.
What are you looking at?
Don't berate the callers.
Give the line.
I pity the fool.
All right, stop right there. Let's go to Kelly's in Wichita, Kansas. Hello, Kelly. We're getting a lot of out-of-staters today.
How did they call you?
Kelly, you're on the MJ Morning Show. Good morning.
Hey, guys. Good morning.
All right, Kelly, did you hear the impersonation? Or you want
to pity a guy who has a girl's name.
All right, who is?
I did, but I want to hear it again.
All right, go ahead.
I have a mohawk. I pity the fool who a guy named Kelly. Pity.
All right, who do you think it is?
That's some classic Mr. T right
That's
there.
That's right. Yeah. Yeah. Mr. T. There. Mr. T. What else could I have done? I don't know.
That is correct.
Oh. Hulk Hogan. Now,
he gets to pick. Hold on. Does he get to?
Yeah, he gets another one. Yeah.
You get to pick another one.
Congratulations, Kelly.
You cleaned up aisle six on the last caller. All right. So, Kelly, who do you want to play with?
Let's go with Fester.
Oh.
All right.
Hey, is this the first time Fester's been?
I did Alec Baldwin.
Oh, that's right. All right. Fester's reaching in, picking out a celebrity connection, impression, whatever the hell the game's called. All right, here's Fester.
Hello, Kelly. Yes, my loyal subject, Kelly, by royal decree, I shall make you the Prince of Wichita, Kansas. Hello. Oh, yes. Oh, Prince Philip,
Kelly,
I miss you so much,
Kelly,
Prince Philip.
Who the hell is Fester impersonating?
Oh, I hate that Meghan Markle.
I'm going to guess that would be... Queen Elizabeth.
Yeah! It was all about the way you said royalty.
That was good, but were you British?
Who the hell cares? Yeah.
You are
like
correct.
Mrs. Doubtfire.
Guys, are we going to wrap this up now? I mean, the lines are jammed.
I don't even know. How do we?
All right, let
how
me,
does it end again?
We just end it when we want to end it.
We have four more people on hold here. I have at least four more names in the bucket.
All right, let's go with Jen. Jen is in Bradenton. Yeah. Jen, you're on the MJ Morning Show, and Andrew's screening more calls now. Jen, welcome to the MJ Morning Show. Hi.
Good morning.
Impression connection. Who do you want to play with?
I think she's Roxanne.
Okay. All right. The team consensus in the car there or something, right?
You were just consulting with someone in the car. Who were you consulting with?
My son, Ethan, and I listen to this show every morning.
All right.
Well, thank you, guys.
We big Hal Herman fans, huh?
All right. Roxanne is chosen again. Roxanne, go ahead and reach in and pick out a name and give us the impression.
Okay. All right, here we go.
Anytime now.
Yeah.
I'm going to tell you my likes and dislikes. I love vodka. I hate the Ukraine. I have a lot of children, some daughters you know of. I don't speak of them. Some daughters from another.
Who do you think it is? Who do you think it is? Who?
It's Putin.
Oh, God. I mean, I don't want to get too excited because Putin's a son of a, you know.
Yeah, but golly. But he does love vodka and he does hate the Ukraine, so that was a very accurate impression.
Was that your son that guessed?
Yeah.
What? And how old is your son?
I'm 11.
Oh, that is fantastic.
Vladimir Putin.
That is fantastic that 11-year-old kid got Vladimir Putin.
Smart kid.
Who is one of the most evil villains on Earth right now.
But very impressionable.
All right, so
I'm shocked too, MJ. I'm shocked as well.
I'm sorry.
I was trying to remember Jen's name. So, Jen, what's your son's name so we can give him some accolades? What?
My name is Ethan.
Ethan, fantastic, buddy. Thank you for calling in.
Cool. Thanks.
Teamwork, Ethan. We did it.
Ethan, have a great day at school and have a great weekend, buddy.
Mom, it's Vladimir Putin.
Thank you.
Bye, guys.
That was cool, huh?
Did I say accolades or alkalades?
I don't know.
I don't know what the hell I said. All right, man, I guess we'll keep going. What time is it? Right, we got a few more minutes here. Jeff is next on the MJ Morning Show. Jeff, welcome to the program.
Thank you.
All right, Jeff.
How are you guys today?
I am doing well, Jeff. Now, Jeff, which of the crew do you want to play with?
I'll play against my old neighbor.
And who's that?
That's you, my man, MJ.
Well, what? Jeff. Oh, Jeff, you used to be my neighbor?
I don't want to call out over the air the name of the street we lived on, but I remember instead of your BMWs, you used to drive a really nice red Toyota Supra.
Oh, you know,
that's a long time ago.
So I had a 1994 Toyota Supra, a twin turbo. You know, I should have held on to that car because those things are going for a fortune these days.
Oh, they're tripled in value now.
They are. My son Julian, he kicks me like once a week. Dad, why'd you sell that Supra? Why'd you get rid of the Supra?
All right, let's get to the impressions.
All right, Jeff.
Okay, yes, sir.
All right, hand me the bucket. All right.
There's only a few in there now.
All right, here we go. All right, Jeff, the impression is as follows. Born in the USA, I was born in the USA.
That is Bruce Springsteen.
Man, you can't just sing the song. I mean, you gotta be like this. Hey, all I care about is unions and everybody in New Jersey. And I'm a working man and I gotta work
Wait a sec. I'm charging $5,000 for my concert tickets. For the working man.
Yeah. I did a shot of tequila and I drove off and got arrested. Didn't you get arrested for that?
Jeff.
Drunk on a bike, yeah.
Jeff, are you still on my old street or did you move?
No, I actually moved to Bradenton, but I remember you passing by and we'd wave at you. I'd lived on that corner there. We had the CRXs, the Hondas.
Oh, yeah.
Guy with the Honda.
So you were right at Linwood, right?
No, I was on Wallcraft on the corner of Himes and Wallcraft.
That's right. So right at Wallcraft and Himes. Okay, I know exactly who you are.
It's
been a long time.
And then keep in mind that right down the street, Fester lost control of his pickup and smashed into a tree at the YMCA on Himes.
That's true. Good times.
God, you never know what's going to happen on the Impression Connection.
I did not know that was him. Yep. But
right. Yep. Surprises. Hey,
Jeff,
everywhere.
Great to hear from you again, buddy. Have a great day.
Hey, you too, bud. Thanks.
Bye-bye. Jeff.
Look at that old
surprise contestant.
Old guy from the old South Tampa neighborhood. Yeah, all right, we've got a couple more.
Listen to MJ acting like he remembers him. Oh, yeah, you're the guy with the Honda. Yeah, I remember that.
I'm going to take two more, and that's it. I think we only have like two more in the bucket.
We busted through them today.
All right, let's go to Sandy. Sandy is next on the MJ Morning Show Impression Connection. Sandy, let's go. Who do you want to play with?
Are you talking to me?
We are, Sandy.
That's Joe Pesci.
Welcome. Sandy, who do you want to play with?
Susie.
I'm sorry, say it again.
I'm Susie.
Oh, the screen says Sandy.
I thought you wanted to play with Susie. Okay.
Hey.
That's okay.
All right, so, Susie, who do you want to play with?
Give me the Gabagool.
Ooh.
The Gabagool.
All right.
Is that Fester?
You can just call us by name.
I'll give him the bucket.
Do you want to play with Fester? Is that it?
Yeah.
All right, here we go.
Let's go.
All right, let's shake it up. Hurry up, guys. I'm up against
shake
the clock
it
here.
You and me, Susie. Here you go.
I've done an extended segment with Impression Connection today. All right, go ahead, Fester. Do the impersonation.
Susie from Brooksville. You dynamite!
That's all I got. That's it. That's all I got.
Jimmy. What the hell is his name?
You're there.
Good times.
You're there. What's his last name?
Say the thing for the commercial.
Here's him modern day. If you would like the most of your Medicare benefits, call this number.
Dynamite!
I just can't think of his last name.
Hold on. She said
Did
Jimmy.
Did you know his first name?
She said That's Jimmy good. And Good Times.
Yeah, that works.
Well, give it to him.
She's really got it.
Right. She knows who it is.
I'm going to give it to her. It's Jimmy JJ. Okay.
Walker.
Yes! Dynamite! She's got it. All right. Thanks for playing along. All right. Last one. Is it Tirva or is it Turva? How do you pronounce your name?
It's Tirza.
Like tear.
Like a teardrop, but with a Z-A on the end.
Oh, like you're having a tear in Virginia. Oh, Tirva.
Lovely.
Yeah.
All right, Tirva, let's go. You're the final contestant on Impression Connection. Who do you want to play with?
I want to go with Roxanne.
All right. Here we go. Rock. By the way, I'm ending this. So whether she gets it or not, I'm ending it right here because I got to move on.
Oh, I'm gonna get it.
All right, let's go, Roxanne. Do the impression. Oh, Roxanne is like.
That's why I picked her because she's like the best and the funniest.
Yeah, no, that's
thank
right.
You. Thank you, love.
Okay, don't let her down. Let's go.
I got to get in my head and listen to the person.
Listen, I got a hard break here coming up. Go ahead.
I don't have faith in you.
All right, folks, we got morons in the new. All right, everybody, sit tight. We got morons in the news coming up. Hollywood gossip. We got a rash of people just doing a rash of things.
Oh, my God.
Really? Really? That's in the bucket?
Wait a minute.
Where do you have to go, Roxanne? Tomorrow? Okay, here's where you need to park. I'm a little bit controlling, a little bit of a micromanager. Froggy, you're stupid. Froggy, you never do any bits.
What?
Faster, you're fat. Roxanne, let's play some drops of you saying crude things.
Who are you?
Context.
This is really a name in the bucket.
Ma'am, who is this?
Can I get another shot?
Hold on. Name? No, listen. Tirva. I'm going to call my wife right now, if you could hold on. I'm going to call my wife, Michelle, on the phone. If you could just hold on, please, because I need her to guess.
Oh, my God. Barack Obama?
What?
Barack Obama. I'm just ending this charade. Tirva.
Was that your real answer or was that a joke answer, Tirva?
Tirva, what's your real answer? Was it Barack Obama?
No, I was going to say, I don't know who it is, but it's some type of Karen.
It's
some type of...
Yeah, I got it.
Tirva, it's me, MJ. They're trying to impersonate me, MJ.
You're a
Karen.
Let me call my wife, Michelle. I have morons in the news coming up. Fester's fat, Froggy's dumb, Roxanne's crude thing.
Did you get the name on the camera? Did he get it?
I mean that in the best way.
Oh, my God. That's the way to end it right there.
Tirva, thanks for playing the MJ Morning Show Impression Connection game.
I tried. Great job.
Love you, too.
Thanks a lot.
I almost died.
Oh, my God.
She said Barack Obama. Thank you for hanging out with me on the Impression
there
Connection.
There we go. The Impression Connection on the MJ Morning Show. And that's it. Holy moly. All right, we're running late. All right, I got to pick. All right, we've got a long... We're totally shifting gears next on the MJ Morning Show. We're back in a minute, so don't miss the long segment coming up next. Hey, Kemper... Q105, 856. We got another long chunk of the show starts right now as we head close to the 9 o'clock hour and the final hour of the show on a Friday as we get ready to wrap up the week. I just teased something. I don't know, Roxanne, you were in the room, but was anyone else in the room?
But I was not listening. I'm sorry.
what else is new? Really? And hold on a sec. We got something to add to the Roxanne sound wall.
I'm going to pee my pants.
Oh.
But guess what? It doesn't sound like me.
So. I'm going to pee my pants.
Oh, no, it sounds like you. Say it. Play it again.
I'm going to pee my pants.
She says it a little rushed.
It sounds really weird.
That's high pitched right there.
I'm going to pee my pants.
I'm going to pee my pants.
I'm going to pee my pants.
Stop it.
I'm going to pee my pants.
Okay, enough. We ended on a good impression connection.
Now. All right. I just gave a little teaser, and I said, it's been a month. No one's come forward. Is this going to be a black hole mystery? Is it out there? Is someone just taking their time? Was it lost? Does somebody know that they had it? But does somebody not know they had it, I guess is the way to say it. Do you guys have any idea what I'm talking about?
Absolutely.
What am I talking about, Fester?
The billionaire from Illinois, from Des Plaines.
Nobody has come forward. The $1.34 billion Mega Millions winner, it has been a month, and nobody has come forward. Nobody. $1.34 billion. The prize winner has not made contact with lottery officials yet in Illinois. It was a Speedway gas station in Des Plaines. The ticket was sold on July 29th. And nobody has come forward.
That's crazy.
Now, I would think that 30 days is enough to get your affairs in order, contact financial professionals, a lawyer. Nothing. It's just crickets out there. Now, in large wins with lotteries, some people do take a while to get ducks in a row. And they have the ticket safely put away. Maybe it's in a safety deposit box at the bank or whatever. But there's always the chance that somebody bought, and it happens all the time. People buy lottery tickets. They'll grab a couple of quick picks or whatever. Now, I think it's less likely if you have a habitual player that keeps playing the same numbers over and over and over again.
Yeah, those degenerates, they're all over it. Yeah, they know.
Those people, they check religiously. They know. I'm guessing if the ticket is lost or if it's somebody that has no idea that they have the winning $1.34 billion ticket, I would guess that'd be a quick pick, you know, just somebody filling up gas at a Speedway and you go inside, you get a bag of pretzels and a Slurpee or whatever, and then give me two quick picks on the Mega Millions, right? That's the one that's like $1 billion. But it's been a month, and nobody has said I'm the winner. And also, and in Illinois, you can stay anonymous, and it's not like you have to set up a. Well, listen, you probably want to set up a trust or an LLC anyway. That might be some of the advice, but. It's not like you have to try to set up some kind of a privacy issue because in Illinois, it's one of the states that if you win over $250,000, you can remain anonymous. Now, it's not like Florida. Florida, you can remain anonymous. If you win $250,000 or more, you can remain anonymous in Florida for just 90 days, just 3 months. But in Illinois, if you win over $250,000, you can remain anonymous in perpetuity. So that's a good deal.
Could it be a person who is either in the hospital, had a heart attack or stroke when they found out?
Why do you have to go so morbid on us?
Well, let's go in a positive direction. In jail, got arrested.
Oh, that's positive? Oh, so not dead, but incarcerated, that's positive.
I mean, MJ, think about the things that could give you an instant heart attack. It's reading those numbers off. And you just drop dead right there where you stand.
Now, the Illinois lottery director is Harold Mays. And he said, for a prize of this magnitude, it's not unusual for the winner to take a while to claim. I'm sure they're going through a range of emotions. Or the damn ticket is lost and somebody bought a quick pick and they have no flipping idea that they won $1.34 billion. Yeah, Andrew.
If it was an office pool, as we've seen also win, I wonder if they're waiting for everybody to get everything in order.
No, no, no. If it's an office pool, then it's out because you can't have 20 winners and somebody not spill the beans.
Yeah.
Somebody's
going to
tell somebody, listen, if there's an office pool here and they won and I wasn't part of it and I got wind of it, I'd tell the world.
I'd be so jealous.
Guys, yeah. I want to do a little quiz with you guys. I'm going to give you a number, and I want you to tell me what I'm talking about here. All right? I'm going to give you a number. Everyone, Froggy, Fester, Roxanne.
Okay.
It is now settled. 6.1 inches is the best size of what?
Male private part.
God.
No, no,
I need to answer.
What?
I didn't read that somewhere.
No, Roxanne.
Is that average? Did I read that?
6.1 inches.
Wait.
Wow.
I'm sorry. I wasn't listening to the measurement.
Okay. No, you obviously were, because if it was like 6 feet, you would not have said that. Wait, or maybe you would have.
I just said 6.1 inches. Is the best measurement for this, and you blurt out male private part?
It's Friday. Let's just be loosey-goosey.
I mean, I was going to go with a soup spoon, but Roxanne.
I didn't ask about any personal questions over here, Roxanne, but...
I thought I read that statistic, that's the average size. I don't know.
What do you read? When did the Wall Street Journal cover that?
No, Roxanne. The best smartphone screen size is 6.1 inches, not okay. A wang.
Hold on. Let me hold my phone to myself and see. Right. Oh, yeah, my phone's much bigger.
Guys, will you stop it?
Roxanne?
Folks, I'm talking about smartphone technology here. All right, apparently it's... Roxanne, really?
Look, if we...
You gonna wangulate the show here?
If we look at what we've talked about this week, everything is about what do people do now that they're not at work, or now that they work from home, they watch porn. Everything has been a sort of answer.
Another MJ impression?
why don't you just do MJ impression for the rest of the segment?
All right. Apparently, the word is out. The research is done that the best smartphone screen size is 6.1 inches. And I guess that's the form factor, that's the size of the screen that I guess people like most.
You know what? So. I have the iPhone 12 Max.
Yep.
It's 6.7 inches.
Right.
And I wouldn't mind it being a little smaller.
So you think your screen is too big?
Yeah, I think 6.1, I think that's the right number.
All right, now let's see here. I've got the Pixel 6 Pro, and that is 6.7 inches also. So I've got the Pixel 6
Pro. How do you know? What, do you got a ruler?
No, I'm reading
the thing called Google.
Well, no, the story that I have about 6.1 inches is the best screen size that people seem to like best. In the story, it says that my phone, I have a Pixel 6 Pro, and it's 6.7 inches. So I think the screen size that I have is fantastic. Hey, are you following this Tom Brady thing that's popped up online?
More of him.
Well, no, this is interesting. There are big time, like, degenerate gamblers that are betting big that the Buccaneers are going to melt down. That this season, the Buccaneers are going to have an awful, awful season. Listen to this. This came from CBS Sports.
When your quarterback misses the entire preseason, that's not a good omen.
Now, he's supposed to start, I hear, this weekend. Brady is going to start.
One or two series, maybe.
Right, but he's going to start this weekend's final preseason game.
It's up in Indianapolis, isn't it?
Is it Colts?
Yes.
All right. So, listen to this story here. And I saw this yesterday. I'm like, whoa, I don't know. Tom Brady, NFL starter now for 21 years. But gamblers are betting against Brady and our Tampa Bay Buccaneers this year. Not only are the Buccaneers the most popular under bet at Caesars Sportsbook, but there's also tons of money bet on them to have the NFL's worst record this season.
What?
I don't get that.
Why would they do that? Why would they say that?
What is it? Why are tons of gamblers betting against the Bucks? One bettor at Caesars has bet $300 at 350-1 odds that the Buccaneers will have the worst record in the NFL. I mean, that's not a lot of money to take some kind of a crazy bet.
Look, if I go to Vegas, I'll spend $100 on the longest odds and hope something ridiculous happens.
But just going by the numbers, the sports books in Vegas, it looks like professional gamblers, they're saying, are betting on the Bucs to have a crap bag season. Which
thanks a lot.
I wouldn't expect that.
No,
would you?
I wouldn't either. No.
Haters.
Even if you're like, I'm trying to think of the rationale behind that. Maybe they think, okay, like Fester said, Tom Brady was out for the part of the preseason. It's like a senior skip year and he's just laid back. But then you have the whole rest of the team and Tom's a winner. He's not going to try to go out without an amazing season and another Super Bowl championship.
All right. I know we have a lot of people listening that are tatted up. I don't think anyone on the show, Roxanne, do you have a tattoo?
No, you've asked me this before. I do not.
Okay, so Roxanne, I don't think Fester, you don't have a tattoo.
I don't.
All right, Froggy, you don't have a tattoo, do you?
I do actually.
No, you don't.
I have a United States of America tattooed on my ween.
All right.
Sometimes it says USA. I get it.
I got a hysterical joke.
Really?
The punchline is Wendy. You know,
all right, guys, come on.
Come on, I used to tell that one in sixth grade. The kids would laugh.
All right, listen. I've got a serious story here. Tattoo ink used in the United States may contain a cancer-causing chemical, according to a new study.
Oh, no.
A new study suggests that almost half of all tattoo ink used in America contains a cancer-causing chemical. Researchers from SUNY Binghamton, so that's the State University of New York at Binghamton, they analyzed 56 popular inks used by American tattoo artists, uncovering that 23 of them have potentially hazard azo compounds. Is that azo or azo? It's A-Z-O.
Go with azo. It just sounds funnier.
While azo compounds are not a cause for concern, while chemically intact, bacteria and ultraviolet light may degrade them into another compound that is carcinogenic. Now, is this a real deal or is this like some unnecessary scare crap?
All right, so in its tattoo ink form, it's not harmful, but they're saying possibly over the course of a lifetime of UV exposure, it could break down?
UV, bacteria, yeah, that it could break down. So what, the components could be carcinogenic? That's what it sounds like.
Yeah.
Very little is actually known about the composition of tattoo ink, so we started analyzing popular brands, according to John Swirk, who's the lead author from SUNY Binghamton, put out a statement at the fall meeting of the American Chemical Society. That's the ACS.
Ooh, that sounds nice.
Yes, the American Chemical Society. Surprisingly, no dye shop makes pigments specific for tattoo ink. Big companies manufacture pigments for everything such as paint and textiles. These same pigments are used in tattoo inks. Interesting. But does this translate into... Okay, so they're claiming that some of these inks break down and can be carcinogenic, but is it so little that maybe the compounds, if you give like 37,000 pounds to a lab rat, might get cancer? Is it one of those stories where if you have a tattoo of mom on your bicep in a heart, that is it too little to do anything? Is this like one of these alarmist scare stories, you know?
We've tattooed 6 rats completely in orange.
How do people who get tattoos not get ink poisoning?
They don't ingest it. I don't know.
No, because it's
like... Don't act like you know.
I don't know. I said I don't know. I don't drink it.
I mean, you get ink poisoning if you get stabbed with ink.
I wonder if we have any tattoo artists that are listening to the show right now. Because listen, tattoos are popular. I just have no desire. You know, Michelle doesn't have a tattoo. I don't think she's ever had any desire to get tatted up.
For me, I just worry, like, what is it going to look like when I'm much older? You know, that's why I haven't done it. And I don't like anything enough to put it on my body forever.
Allison has one tattoo.
No, she doesn't.
Yeah, it's on her back, and it says, I'm with idiot, and it's an arrow. She always makes me walk on that side.
Hey, are there any tattoo artists listening? 800-990-1047. Have you heard about this? I think it's one of these, you know, just scare stories. I just can't imagine that anyone's getting. I wonder if somebody that's like all sleeved up, if you've got somebody that has like a whole like shoulder down the arm sleeve attached, if that, I would imagine if you have more ink in you, that's going to change the potential here. But,
you know,
overall, I just think this is somewhat of a scare tactic story.
Yeah, everything's bad for you. Like, they'll tell you there's stuff in certain shampoos that's chemically and bad for you. So everything's bad for you. If you like tattoos, get them.
Oh, hang on a minute. You're not falling for that. Oh, yeah, the Laurel sulfate or Laurel sulfate.
Yeah,
oh, yeah, that's carcinogenic. It's like the first ingredient in shampoo, and it's like the sudsing agent, which that's an old, like, internet, scam urban legend deal. Listen, if there are any tattoo artists listening, anybody in the tattoo business, phone up. 800-990-1047. 800-990-1047. Andrew, go ahead and screen some calls here. I see the phones ringing over here. Before I move on. But the American Chemical Society.
Hey, I want a tattoo artist to call in right next to the little tattoo gun, and I want to hear it.
Have that thing vibrating away, right? So tattoo inks contain two parts, a pigment and a carrier solution.
Okay.
And the pigment could be a molecular compound such as a blue pigment or a solid compound such as titanium dioxide.
I'm going to go down to Atomic Tattoos after the show, and I'll interview everybody.
Hey, Michelle's on the line. Hi, Michelle. Welcome to the MJ Morning Show. Are you a tattoo artist?
I am not a tattoo artist, and I'm turning down the radio in my car, so okay. I hope you can hear me through my car phone.
Okay.
I just wanted to say I was opposed to tattoos my entire life, and after I left my very abusive husband of 27 years, I got a tattoo in rebellion to him, and it has a date on it, which is the date I left him, and my freedom and my life started to begin at age 49.
Oh, right.
Wow.
Well, thank you for...
Wow. All right, so how long ago is this, Michelle?
I'm going to be 55 in less than 2 weeks, so it was about 5 years ago.
All right, still in the demo. All right.
Thank you.
That was weird. Okay. Yeah.
Thank you for
congratulations.
Calling.
Well, listen, Michelle, I'm glad that you've, we triggered something with the tattoo. And have you gotten any more tattoos or you stopped at one?
I have a little ladybug tattoo because I collect ladybugs. And it's like right below my collarbone on the right side.
All right.
And then I did get a tattoo. My kids have, because of them growing up in that household, I always tried to tell them I loved them to the moon and back. And so my daughters got a tattoo of a semi-crescent moon that says to the moon, dot, 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 to the moon and back. And mine says, I love my kids, dot, dot, dot.
Oh, all right. So anyway, first of all, I'm glad that you didn't murder your husband, because I think I've seen this on a Lifetime movie in the past, you know?
It was not physical. It was verbal, mental, and emotional abuse. And in my opinion, can be worse than physical, because those words stick with you the rest of your life.
Well, listen, I hope you're in a better place. It sure as hell sounds that way, all right?
What's worse is actually loving your kids.
All right, hey, thanks, Michelle.
I'm married to a man that adores me now, and so life is good.
Okay.
Michelle. Fester's getting angry.
What, therapy for you, Michelle? I appreciate you listening.
We're talking about
tattoo poisons, and she's going over her whole therapist list.
So why are you getting angry at Michelle?
Michelle, thank you for calling. Hang up.
Michelle, listen, thank you.
Hang up the phone, MJ.
Michelle, ignore Fester, okay?
Michelle, I love you. Thank you for listening.
Goodbye, Michelle.
That's just a lot.
MJ, I thought you had a Blues Brothers tattoo.
Dude, I don't have a Blues Brothers.
No, you had a B on one cheek and a B on the other cheek, and you showed us.
Yeah.
And Fester goes, who's Bob?
All right, whatever. All right,
I would tell you my mom wild joke.
Hey, Fessy, you're turning into like a crazy.
No, that was such a pleasant call.
Yeah. You're like a cranky guy.
Am I? We just get done with the impression connection. I'm the cranky one. Thank you for listening, Michelle.
You've turned into a cranky guy.
Absolutely not. You forgot how to hang up on people.
I forgot how to hang up on people.
My joke was.
All right, listen. Bottom line is, I don't need your joke.
That was a good one.
Bottom line here is, I guess we don't have any tattoo artists that are listening to the MJ Morning Show.
Michelle can call in and save her insurance company 2 years of therapy bills.
Hey, folks, did you check the backseat of your car before you got in this morning?
My wife checks her backseat of her car every time she gets in her car.
You got to be pretty paranoid.
Every time.
Is that true?
Yep. She looks in the back.
What is it about that? Does she have a phobia? She's got a fear?
You know what?
What do you think? She's a boogeyman's going to be back there?
I think we were watching a movie or something. Yeah, we're watching a movie, and the woman just takes off in the car, and she's like bopping along, and then like this head just like pops right up and scared the crap out of her. She checks the car.
Let me tell you why. You probably need to check the back seat of your car. And it's not like some kind of a slasher horror movie thing. But after I tell you this story, I'm thinking that people are going to check the back seat of their cars from now on.
Oh, man.
A woman up in Rhode Island drove to work in Massachusetts. So she lives in Rhode Island and she drives to work in Massachusetts, crosses the state line. And this week, she drove with a partially naked, extremely intoxicated man lying on the floor in the back of her car.
Oh, wow.
Oh, my God.
How does that even happen? I mean, lock your door.
Jose Osorio, a 21-year-old from Providence, Rhode Island, has been charged with breaking and entering into her vehicle after the driver, Amanda Keene, discovered her or him when she arrived early Monday morning at her job at Honeydew Donuts.
Sounds delicious.
Yeah, we've actually been to Honeydew Donuts.
Sounds really good, yeah.
These are up in New England. You'll see them in Massachusetts. You'll see them in Rhode Island. I think we've seen them in Vermont and Maine. Honeydew Donuts. And, of course, the dominant donut place up there in Massachusetts is Dunkin' Donuts.
Yeah, sure.
I'll tell you what, Dunkin' is on every 12 feet there's a Dunkin' up there. But can you imagine that? She gets to work and there's a drunk guy in the back floor that's half naked? Yeah, she did an interview with WJAR Television in Providence and said, I don't know how to put it into words. It really took my mind a minute for me to understand what I was seeing. Yeah, naked guy drunk in the back seat of your car and you just drove to work with a dude on the floor behind you? How creepy is that?
How do you not, like, hear him or smell him? Or?
Oh, my God.
I don't get it.
Terrifying. Yeah.
Keene reportedly drove 45 minutes to work.
How's it possible?
Yeah, I mean, I could see, you know, if you just get in and crank your radio up and you can't hear anything. But, wouldn't you smell somebody in your car?
I'm glad you said that. I'm about to give you some more details. So she drove 45 minutes. She included a stop for gasoline. She was using headphones to listen to a true crime podcast
it's not safe.
During the commute.
Not supposed to do that.
You're not supposed to be. I think it's illegal in most states. If you're wearing headphones in your car, I believe that's illegal because you can't hear horns or emergency vehicles. Oh, wait a sec. Let me grab Patty. Patty's in Tampa. Hey, Patty, you're on the MJ Morning Show. Did we strike a nerve with this backseat special here or what?
Mine's not as scary.
What happened in your backseat?
Okay. I worked for a woman at her house. And at the end of the day, when I was loading up, at the time I drove a minivan, and I was loading my things back into my vehicle, and I left to go home, and I live about 20 minutes away, so I got almost to my house, and I heard like an exhale in my vehicle. And so I looked in my rearview mirror, and on my third row seat, her golden retriever was laying on my back seat.
Oh, wow.
Her dog?
So the dog, I guess, when I was loading my stuff, had climbed into my vehicle and laid there. And I didn't see it, and it just exhaled, or I guess I would have left it in the car overnight. So now I always check my back seat.
I'm just thinking of Tommy Boy and the deer that comes back alive in the back seat of the car, right? You know, shreds the whole convertible top.
All right, Patty, because the dog wasn't left in a locked car, this is almost a happy story. You find the dog, you turn around.
Yeah.
What the hell was that?
But I was so frustrated because I was done with work for the day, and now I have to go all the way back and drop the dog off.
Aw. That's a sweet story.
But it was a good ending. Anyway, that's much better than a drunk, naked guy in the back of your car. Thanks a lot. When I think of, like, the back seat, what's that Poison song? Do you have the hook ready to go? I hit it. Go ahead. At the drive-in, in the old man's There we go. Oh, it wasn't the back seat.
It was in the old man's Ford.
Yeah, yeah. That's right. Well, let the hook play, Andrew. You can let it go. Go on. Let's get the hook. At the drive-in. The old man's Ford. Not the back seat, though. It was behind the bushes. The basement. Lock the cellar door.
Yeah, what's he going to do to
it? Baby. All right, little Brett Michaels. Little Poison this morning on the MJ Morning Show. All right, final chunk of the program for the week is next. We got a lot of loose ends to cover. Man, today's been I've really liked today's show.
It's been really good.
It's been a really good show.
Well, I'm just house hanging out.
Yeah, house hanging out. Really good show. Hang on. Final chunk of the MJ Morning Show is coming up in just a bit. And this is ridiculous. Have you heard? right, you got the MJ Morning Show at Q105. MJ and the crew. That's weird. My my headphones are like in one ear only. Did I like break a wire over here or something? It's a little strange.
Give him a little jostle. Mine do that too.
No, no. It's like, did I hit a button? Oh, I hit. Oh yeah, I hit a button. Thank you, man. Yeah, I hit a button on the board. This is the worst console ever.
All right, come on.
All right. Anyway, we have a lot to do here. How much time do we have? All right, we got about 12 minutes or so. We got a lot to cover. First of all, heads up for Britney Spears. Britney Spears, literally 9 hours ago, literally at midnight, the first new music from Britney Spears came out in years, and she's teamed up with the Rocket Man. She's teamed up with Elton John.
What?
Yeah.
I think it's already number one in like 50 countries.
All right, hang on a minute. If you haven't heard it, we got a little bit of the song here in just a minute here on the MJ Morning Show on Q105. This nightclub story is nuts. I don't know if I believe this. I don't do a lot of foreign stories, but this is crazy. Come on. A nightclub in Australia has banned people from staring at somebody unless you have verbal consent to be able to stare.
How are you going to put the vibe out?
I'll stare at you, please.
Hello.
Come on. This is insane. An Australian nightclub is going to remove people who are caught staring at somebody without that person's consent that they're allowed to stare. Club 77 in Sydney? Are you kidding me? What, if you see an attractive woman on the dance floor or an attractive woman at the bar and you just gaze, you look, you're just trying to take in the attraction, the beauty, that if you don't, what, you go up to them, you got to say, oh, excuse me, I find you, isn't that creepy?
And how awkward is that going to be? Then you ask and you get their permission. Yeah. Then do you just stare at them?
Do you mind if I stare at you?
You're so attractive. Can I just gaze at you? Can I just stare? Can I have your permission? Can I have your consent to stare?
Oh, crikey. I'm looking at you at the Australian club.
And I'm having a Foster's and I want to know if I can stare at you.
Listen, mate. Let me check out your wobblies.
I'll give you permission to stare at my boobs, but not at my butt.
Ideal. Club 77 in Sydney, they say that they have a zero tolerance policy. This is updated on harassment. And just looking at somebody is now considered harassment? Oh, Mike, take this woke stuff and just, you know what you can do with it.
The very ugly men that get stared at because of all the wrong reasons are very happy about this rule.
This is ridiculous. All right, moving along. Did you notice this week? I meant to mention this, I think, on Wednesday. Was it Wednesday? Yeah, I think so. I think it was Wednesday. I think it happened Tuesday into Wednesday. Did anyone notice that gas prices went up like 20 to 25 cents a gallon like overnight this week?
What's up with that?
You know what? Andrew, did you notice that as well? Did you see that?
Yes, I told you that.
Yeah, Andrew's the first person I heard it from, and I was thinking in my head, God, I wish this guy would just shut up. He doesn't know what he's talking about. 25 cents. And then I leave, and all the gas prices jumped up. Dude, I'm like, oh, my God.
What do you mean there's nobody he's talking about? So I paid, the last time I filled up my car, I paid $3.34 a gallon.
Right.
$3.34 a gallon. And now the gas is like in the 350s.
Yeah.
So what I do? I'm looking all over the place. I'm doing searches. I'm trying to find stories. What happened? Why did gasoline jump like 20 to 25 cents a gallon overnight this week? So I sent a tweet. I sent a message on Twitter to, you know, the Gas Buddy guy. You ever see that guy, Patrick DeHaan?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
He's the Gas Buddy guy. And, you know, Gas Buddy is that website where they track gas prices. They've got an app and everything. You can check on gas prices all over the country, in your area. And I sent him a note on Twitter. I didn't know if he was going to respond, but I wrote, at Gas Buddy Guy, why did gas prices shoot up 20 to 25 cents a gallon overnight this week in the Tampa Bay area? And this guy, Patrick DeHaan, he responds like within an hour.
That's cool.
To me, and he replies to at Todd Schnitt, that's my Twitter handle. And he wrote, prices cycled, basically fell below replacement cost because stations kept one-upping each other. Wholesale prices jumped, forcing stations to pass the higher cost and restore their margins. So That's a pretty concise description of why gas prices went up 20 to 25 cents a gallon overnight this week. So if you were wondering, there you go. That's what happened. All right, air fryers. I want one. And Michelle was like, we have enough small appliances in the house. You're not getting an air fryer. I'm getting an air fryer at some point. I want one. However, I guess you don't leave it on because a kitchen burned to the ground.
Yeah, they put out a lot of heat and out of the back.
Yeah, in Spring Hill, an air fryer was left on overnight, and it totally destroyed the kitchen in a Spring Hill home.
Ooh.
This happened on Wednesday morning. Now they're mourning their kitchen. Yeah, Hernando County fire crews, they went to Galliano Court, which is near County Line Road, about 6 o'clock in the morning, and the kitchen was on fire. How does that song go?
This kitchen's on fire.
There you go. Whoa. All right, stop. Stop. Thank you, Fester Keys.
I can keep going.
Nope, don't keep going.
Okay.
Yeah. But I guess the air fryer was left on, and I didn't know that the appliance could then burn your house down. I mean, the kitchen's a total loss, completely done, over. This is sad. Guess who has passed on?
All kinds of people.
When I say Peach Pit, what comes to mind?
Oh, my God.
What?
Not Tad. What's his name?
I don't know.
You're close.
When you say Peach
What's
Pit.
What's his name?
Nat.
Nat, yeah.
Oh.
Nat. The guy that played Nat.
He's dead.
Who ran the Peach Pit on Beverly Hills 90210 has passed away. That was the hangout, folks, for Brandon and Brenda and Dylan and Kelly.
And David.
Yeah, you know, he's had Alzheimer's since 2014, and that's got to be terrible. And he passed away at the age of 85. Joey Tata.
Always loved that name.
You saw the name up on the screen?
Oh, yeah. I was like, Joey Tata's. Yeah. That's awesome.
So rest in peace. And then finally here, I think it's finally, yeah, Britney Spears. Couple of things. I think Britney deleted her Instagram account again. 55.8 million followers. I'm trying to get to 10,000, and she's got 55.8 million.
And just deletes it.
And she deleted it. And something about choosing happiness. You know, you got a lot of celebrities that are like bowing out of social media, saying that social media is screwing up their mental condition.
Yeah, I'm sure.
I'm all mental because of social media.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously.
I need to be medicated.
Yeah.
So.
You should follow my TikTok. You feel a lot better.
All kidding aside, I guess midnight, early this morning, 9 hours ago, Britney Spears and Elton John dropped the song. It's like this radical rework of Hold Me Closer, Tiny Dancer. Yeah.
Oh, all right.
It's called Hold Me Closer, which is a lyric, obviously.
One of the best Elton John ballads.
Well, also, that was in Almost Famous. That's a great movie, Almost Famous. So let's end the show with just a little bit of Britney Spears here. And this, again, is brand new. It's Elton John and Britney Spears, and it's called Hold Me Closer. And this is Britney's first new music in years and just dropped earlier today. Listen to a little bit here. It's tiny, of course, yes. But they're calling it Hold Me Closer. Hold me closer. Hold me closer. Hold me closer. Fester, you're remarkably quiet over there.
This sucks.
We're listening to the music.
This is so bad.
What?
This is a bucket of stank.
I'm not a fan.
Is Elton John just so rich? He's like, yeah, Brittany, let's just make stupid songs now.
Make one of my songs.
I actually like it.
Oh, this is awesome.
I like it too. I think it has a nice vibe.
Open your Instagram back up and start doing jumping jacks, Brittany.
Fester.
This is awful.
Well, leave it to Fester to end the show on a...
You guys are all wrong. Yes. This is terrible.
Yeah, Fester Downer over there.
I said I don't like it that much.
All right, folks, have a great weekend. We'll see you back here on Monday. Websites loaded. A bunch of videos like the guy throwing gas and lighting the convenience store on fire because he didn't like his cigar that he bought. All right, we got crazy stuff. So go to MJMorningShow.com, MJMorningShow.com, and we'll see you back here on Monday on the MJ Morning Show on Q105. And let's be careful out there.